which will set the rest of the grid for Thursday's races. In qualifying race one, the bottom 18 from qualifying practice will prepare to do battle. No championship points are up for grabs here, but the top two finishers will secure themselves a place in race one, along with the fastest 12 from qualifying practice, where championship points are indeed up for grabs. Qualifying race two is much the same as qualifying race one, but this time 16 riders will battle it out for just one spot that will see them transfer into race two. The top 15 of the championship after race two will race in the super final, where double points will be on offer. The rider with the most points after that will be crowned the winner and become the first FAM Mini GP World Series champion.
Hello, good morning, and welcome to the FIM Mini GP World Series final, coming to you live from the Circuit Ricardo Tormo in Valencia. Not the full Grand Prix circuit, I kid you not. This is the FIM Mini GP World Series specific circuit, where the layout is very, very similar to that of its Grand Prix, well, I guess we could say cousin. My name is Matt Dunn. Alongside me today is Fran Wahl, bringing you the commentary. We will have Matt Burt, one of the MotoGP commentators, down in pit lane, down at the circuit there, bringing you all the updates. What a day we have ahead, though. Plenty of racing to come. This is the first step on the Road to MotoGP program. The very first. Then, well, whatever awaits these young riders, well, that will be one for the history books in a little while's time. But today, plenty of racing coming along. Cannot wait for this. We've already had all the qualifying and free practices for yesterday. Fran Wild, a very good morning to you. Welcome. I really can't wait for this. What a setup. About time we made this happen, don't you think?
Good morning. Yes, it is quite a setup they've got down there. It's just kind of behind turn one, for those of you who know the circuit, Ricardo Tormo, a little bit. And they've got the mini GP pit lane area. There's a grandstand down there as well, as you can see here, which is nice for all those guys who've come with the competitors to be able to keep an eye on the action. And yeah, it's all set up and ready to go. We had some track action yesterday with free practice qualifying. Now all that's left to do is race.
Yeah, look at that as well. We got the safety car on track, the riders coming round to fill up the grid after their starting lap as well. It's absolutely awesome. It is really simply a mini version of MotoGP, isn't it?
It is indeed. Yeah, it had a lot of fans yesterday as well. Obviously, mm-hmm. we published the ambassadors for each series this season with some MotoGP riders, kind of giving some tips and tricks to those guys who will be competing. And a few of them really were enamoured. Everyone was really lovely, but especially Pol Espargaró stayed there the whole afternoon. He went there, did his interview and, like, you know, everything that it was required of him. Then I think went back, got a sandwich and went back and just stayed the rest of the day.
Yeah.
So it was really nice to see genuinely so much interest in the series. And it's a great new step on the road to MotoGP, like you said, the first one.
Absolutely. Quite right there. Well, we are down on the grid with riders having their tyre warmers put on and everything like that. We can pass down to our pit lane reporter, though, Matt Burt, to tell us what the conditions are like down there. Matt, it must be quite an experience being down there for this very first time.
Yeah, morning, guys. It is an incredible experience. As you can imagine, there's quite a lot of nerves, quite a tense atmosphere down here on the grid. Everybody excited, though, to kick off this new Road to MotoGP. Conditions,
maybe,
guys.
Maybe we have some technical issues there because you can hear him, can you? Oh, well, it's just me then. Matt, please continue talking.
Yeah, sorry about that, guys.
I can
yeah.
hear you fine. Sorry.
That's good news, Fran. It's always good that one of you at least is listening to my wise words. Just an update on the conditions, guys. Down here, it is absolutely perfect. Gorgeous, clear blue skies. No breeze whatsoever. These guys cannot wish for more ideal conditions. You know it's hot. I love a few layers at this time of year. I've already taken off two. So, yeah, ideal conditions for this opening qualifying race one. Back to you, guys.
Wow, that really does say a lot. If Matt Burt is taking off layers, truly the king of wanting the aircon on 30 degrees all of the time.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's must be nice down there then. From our position, we are in the normal, quote-unquote, normal commentary box, actually on the Grand Prix track. So we don't have quite this beautiful view that you viewers have. But yeah, it does look perfect conditions. Love the blue and the branding as well, those brollies. It's all looking very profesh down there.
Yeah, it's absolutely brilliant, isn't it? So let's do a little little bit of run through of the grid, shall we? We've just seen a second place rider already, Jesse James Shedden, but actually it's Samuele Boldi who is on pole position for this particular race. The Italian rider, 13 years old, representing the Alp Adria team there. Jesse James Shedden we saw lining up in P2, and this is Blake Wilson from the UK, the number 48. Fran, probably worthwhile before this first race to just like do a little run through about the sort of teams aspect of this. Each, it's countries, isn't it?
It is, exactly, yeah. Kind of, obviously knew this. I do the press for this series as well, so it's something that kind of everyone knows from day one when it comes up as an idea, new plan, and then eventually the reality that we have now. But it was talking to Fahmi Khairuddin, who is kind of the head of the Malaysian one, and he said it might be the first time we've had anything similar in motorcycle racing, where you are kind of racing with your flag rather than with a team and a team name. So yeah, it's a pretty interesting new concept, and they are obviously in this year's series. There are 10 cups that have taken part. There are more joining next year. So it's basically just, yeah, the top guys from each national or regional or continental cup then all come together in the world final. So then they represent that cup that they've come from. And a lot of them are countries, but like you say, the Alpe Adria one is the one that has two nationalities who came to the final. We've got two Italians and one Czech rider from there.
Yeah, quite exciting stuff then. An opportunity to properly represent your country even on the very first step on the road to MotoGP program.
Yep, exactly. And those guys as well in the Alpe Adria series, we will talk about more in a minute. Surprised Tom Lutie as well yesterday with a nice cake to celebrate his 318 starts, of which he'll reach this weekend before he bows out. So then let's have a look at the grid.
Yes, as I mentioned, we have Baldi lining up on for pole position, the number 12. Shedden, 35, second place. Wilson, 48. Then another American, Fernandez, the number 36 in P4 from Mustangy, the Frenchman the number 14, I should say, there, lining up P5. Then Frié, and then Putra, one of the first Malaysians we have, Hafley and Izhar in P9. Behind them on row 4, we have Williams from Matsudaira, the Wakenzi, the American, the actual North American champion from this year. Flyer in just alongside him in P12. Then we have Hamilton, Werity, Giacomino, and Vicente, the Portuguese rider, bringing up the rear there on row 6. Before we get going, though, the times as well, Fran, in free practice of qualifying, is not exactly much disparity. It's a bit Moto2-esque.
Yeah, definitely. There's a couple at the back a little bit further off the pace in the combined free practice sessions, but they just got closer and closer. And yeah, there's some close competition going on in this series already. So good stuff. And you can see then getting a bit frenetic, ready to actually head off and race. And look who it is down there on the grid.
Yeah, John Hopkins. Well, I can see, actually, I think we've got Matt Burt right next to him. So as they're about to head off on their warm-up lap, Matt, what's John thinking of all this?
Yeah, down here with John Hopkins indeed. Matt, John, we know how you love to bring American talent through the World Championship, working with Cameron Beaubier and Sean Dillon-Kelly. Jesse James Hayden, second on the grid, a couple of other Americans in this race. You must be excited to see what they can do.
Yeah, definitely. We have the American Racing Academy, one of our kids as well, Kenzie, is in this race. So I'm in full support of it, man. That's our plan, is helping the kids try and make their way up and get them back into the World Championship. And this is a great start, great event, and it's cool to see.
Awesome job. Go Team USA. We'll catch up with you later on, hopefully.
Yeah, so riders will be heading around for the warm-up lap. It will be a 12-lap race, this one. And, well, I mean, I'm a bit nervous, so I can't imagine what these guys are all like, eh?
I know, yeah, look at this. So we're heading off then on the warm-up lap. And you also saw on your screens, I think, Dorna CEO Carmelo Espeleta down there for this kickoff. So no pressure, guys. You got some real racing royalty down there. But, yeah, I think it's a 10-lap race, this one. Remember, we adjusted the race lengths yesterday, just a little bit less. So it'll be 10 laps of this spectacular little, like you said, almost replica of the circuit Ricardo Tormo. I don't know. I don't really know what to expect from this one. It really is a world first.
Me neither. I'm looking at how similar all the bikes look, especially under the morning sun here in Valencia. And we've got a little bit of timidness with the similar helmets as well. It's going to be difficult calling some of these guys. The numbers aren't exactly too big, are they?
Yeah, please bear
we'll
with us.
We'll give it our best shot. So a little bit of a reminder as they come round to line up on the grid. The top two from this race will go through to race one. So it is absolutely worth watching all the way through. There is the number 12 of Baldi ready to line up.
He is. And also remember, this race, no points. It's just those top two spots to move into the first race with points.
Yeah, there we go then. So red flag at the start of the race. They've got a safety car, full-size safety car on the mini GP track. That's going to be a lot of fun, isn't it? Well then, so it's Baldi, Shedden and Wilson on the front row of the grid. Who will get the whole shot in towards the turn 1-2-3 complex here at the mini Ricardo Tormo circuit? It's go, and it's a great start from Baldi already.
Yeah, great start from the Italian. Just got away nice, well into the lead, and he already has a little bit of a gap there as well, although I'm sure it won't last too long. Looks pretty clean as well. Everybody through that first tight chicane, and it is quite tight. Did a track walk on Tuesday it was, and oof. But yeah, good stuff from these guys then. We're underway.
Looks like Shedden's got in behind him, and then Wilson as well. The Britby's about to get overtaken there, but I think that's Rostagni, is it? The French rider there, the number 14, just trying to make a move, but no way through this time. Quite a little bit of a lead there for Baldi already, but look at this. This is going through the mini turn. Well, it would be turn 13. It is actually turn 13 on this one still.
Yeah, I love it. I'm also struggling to not say Balder instead of Baldi. Yeah. Apologies in advance.
Or Baldassare.
But yeah. But yeah, the Italian doing a great job then at the moment. No nerves at all from pole position. Ooh, and away in the lead. Yeah, another attack there as well.
See, that's a difficult place to go through, Fran, because you've got to brake on the way in and then accelerate through the actual first corner and like skip over the curb. It's not really a great overtaking spot. That so he's going to find it difficult to make a way through there. That is Frié behind him, the number 16, the Frenchman there coming up on the back of this. It looks like Shedden, well, he's not letting Baldi get away here.
Yeah, no, for sure. It looks like it's going to be a good battle through this one. We've still got 9 laps to go, so there's plenty still in this. But yeah, at the moment then, there's got a bit of a French duel there as well between the number 14 and 16. So for the moment, Blake seems to have got away in third place with a little bit more breathing space.
Ooh,
interesting line
round there. Wowee, the front was bobbling there. I think that was on Luca Frié, the number 16, coming through then the final turns and in towards turn one once again. There is just no way through on Wilson there. This looks really difficult to overtake. I've got to say though, Fran, I mean, this is important thing we've got to remember here. This is literally the biggest races of these little guys' lives.
Yeah, it is. It's no pressure, but that's not what they'll be thinking, of course.
No.
The point of Road to MotoGP MotoGP programs is principally to learn and progress, but of course these guys also want to win, and with so much at stake in this race, remember it's only the top two. There's a little bit of glory at stake as well, but it's only the top two who will go through to race one. So at the moment I think we're fairly safe to say that one of those must be Samuele Baldi, unless he has a bit of a disaster, because he is well away now.
Yeah, absolutely. Just noticed one of the Malaysians on the back of that sort of leading group there then, but yeah, it looks like Baldi could have this one absolutely wrapped up. And remind you, it's the top two that will go through into the full race one. Everybody gets to race today, which I think is absolutely awesome. There's Jesse James Shedden. Pretty good day for him yesterday.
It's not, I believe. That's Jaden Fernandez, number 36.
Is it? Oh,
he's
made a three. Oh, my goodness. We're so 35, 36. Well, my eyes have already gotten the better of me then. It's, that, my apologies. Goodness me.
I made the same mistake
early
on.
What's happened to
Fernandez?
Oh, well, apologies to Fernandez. Not giving him his dues whatsoever, have we? I haven't got any live timing at the moment. So, yeah, you're right. Yes, the number 36. So, goodness me, what a start that was. I can only apologise to the young fella there.
Yeah, no, great start. We didn't catch that at all, did we? Certainly something for us to learn for the next race as well. But no, looks like Baldi then, look at that gap. He's really got this wrapped up. If he can keep it nice and tidy and not so much pressure from behind, he can concentrate on what he's doing. But yeah, it's a tight group here. And like you say, that must be Jesse James at the back of that group
there.
With one of the Malaysian riders
in there.
It's
the number 27 of Farris Pucha he's trying to make a move on.
Okay,
I'm pretty
sure
I saw a number 27, but we're not. As I proved already this morning, I'm not too good with numbers.
It is the lights not helping us either. That's not with us. And we've got then also Mattia Rostagni is through on Blake Wilson as well. So that's a nice little close duel there. UK-France, we've seen that before in world history, and it's continued today.
Yeah, and look, this is a proper little quartet then, isn't it, of the sort of chasing group. We've got the number 14 of Rostagni up in two. That will be the second place. So he's managed to overtake Blake Wilson. We have actually missed that at this point. And look at the coverage you got on this circuit, Fem. I mean, it's literally the mini circuit. But all the different camera angles and everything.
I love it.
It's just proper. It's literally mini MotoGP.
It is. It's great. And as well, we've still got 5 laps to go. So this battle really has a lot left to give.
And there's a lot on the line.
There really is, yeah. With the, like we say, top two. Although, if those guys ahead of them, obviously Fernandez and Baldi, if they can't catch them, this is just more for glory in this battle for third, fourth, fifth at the moment. But certainly an interesting one as well, and great to get more track time before the other qualifying race as well.
Worth noting as well, before we carry on with the rest of the day, see how dark the asphalt here. This has been completely relayed, this circuit, and they've had these additional chicanes put in for the start and finish straight for a bit of a safety aspect as well. A completely brand new circuit, because of course actually this circuit is available and has been available for lots of young riders, including Moto3, Moto2, MotoGP riders to train on in winters for years. So they didn't want the Spanish kids and the Italians and French to have an unfair advantage.
Yeah, it's all about parity, this, as it obviously within the technical regulations, it's all equal machinery, bikes are all Ovale, tyres are Pirelli.
Ooh, number 16 trying to make a move on there. Wow, the rear end was proper bobbing there and he's lost out another place there at one of the Malaysians. That is Putra heading up the inside. And then you've got Jesse James Shen just off the back there, really trying to make a way through. But it's all heating up with four laps to go, isn't it?
It certainly is. That was a little bit of a moment, wasn't it? But yeah, the point is obviously equal machinery competition and also an equal platform worldwide. So you can have like the Malaysian kids being able to compete with maybe those from Spain, Italy, who traditionally have a few more opportunities and they're a bit younger to go racing. So yeah, it's everything's about equality and then going out there and doing the business. And certainly Samuel Ibaldi at the moment is doing just that.
Yeah, there we go then. But could it be Matthias Rostagni, the number 14 Frenchman, just coming up behind Jadon Fernandez, the 36 American there, to take that second place and a seat into race one, potentially with three laps to go. He's coming right up behind him in the ribbon now.
He really is. Yeah, this could get a bit spicy because obviously this is the last spot in race one that they'll be fighting over. And Rostagni making great progress to a really
good... Oh, no, that's a massive, massive, massive... Oh, dearie me. That is a big crash there. Good to see him up. Oh, and he's taken another rider down with him. He got a proper bobble on coming out of that final chicane. We got a red flag there. So that is race over for this one then. That was a big, big bobble, wasn't it?
It certainly was. And just so close to getting past that bike on the start finish straight as well. Yeah. Then unfortunately, just another faller there. But red flag then. Wow. And plenty of gravel down on there as well. We'll hopefully get the rider okay soon enough.
There he is, walking away. I mean, there's so much sort of padding all around the circuit and everything, and he doesn't look too shaken by that yet, which is good to see him walk away mainly.
Yeah, for sure. Obviously... Yeah, going to be a bit heartbroken, obviously pushing so hard and just starting to get closer
and closer.
But yeah, so that's a shame for him. But thumbs up, or at least all okay then.
Would have had a bit of a shot there, wouldn't he? I mean, the good thing is, at least when these mini GP bikes, I mean, the speeds obviously are so much lower than what we're used to seeing on like other road to MotoGP programs, the next levels, of course, next level of machinery and everything. So at least when his machine collected the other rider as well, it's a very slow speed accident.
It was, yeah. Not too much drama there, but certainly a lot of drama for the gravel that's now on the track. So someone's going to have to get busy with the broom.
Pick up a broom, Matt Burt. Thank you.
Yeah. Definitely need to get out there, Bertie, do your stuff.
Well, will that be a race result then, Fran?
I think it should be if we're going by the...
You can see the bobbles he had on. What happened here then? So coming across the curbs. Oh, and then just got a bobble on, didn't he? Yeah, really did, unfortunately, but...
He was actually quite a low drama crash for him then.
Is that okay, quickly on the live?
Yeah.
Okay.
But, so unfortunately then, no place in that race one for Rostagni, but... Impressive performance nonetheless.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, should we pass back down to Matt Burt in pit lane? What have you got for us?
Yeah, thanks a lot, Matt. I'm actually here with Loris Caparossi. Loris, you're one of the youngest ever world champions. You must be really happy to see these young guys start their road to MotoGP. And a very impressive performance in that race from Samuele Balda, the Italian rider. What did you make of that?
Yeah, well, it's really amazing for us to see kids like that go quicker. It's really amazing, you know. But... It's really, really impressive. I think today is a great day to see a lot of really strong rider.
Awesome job, Loris. Enjoy the rest of the day. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you very much, Matt and Loris Caparossi. I mean, Fran, you say about all the riders that were here yesterday, the ambassadors, of course. I mean, it was great to see Loris Caparossi, Franco and Chini down here literally all day yesterday.
Yeah, we had a real VIP situation down there yesterday. Mm. And Loris, obviously, one of those with almost... incomparable Grand Prix starts. It's Rossi, Dovi, Kappa Rossi, and then Tom Lutie. And Loris did enjoy a little bit of Tom Lutie's cake as well. Mm. So, you know, not it was bad. A good day out. Well,
there's John Hopkins chatting to Jaden Fernandez. We'll apologise again for thinking calling him Jesse James Shedden for the entire race, but Jesse James did start in second place, so that was a heck of a start from Jaden.
35-36. This is a difficult one with the numbers.
Yeah. Yeah, because, of course, they don't get to choose their numbers either. They are given out to them, aren't they? And it's starting from, I think, number 11, and then it's 11 up to 19, but you don't have round numbers. It's only starting for 31 to 30, etc.
Yeah, it's a tough one for us, so please bear with us as we hopefully get better and better throughout the morning, and by the super final race we'll be absolute heroes with it. Yeah. No promises.
Just quickly,
though.
Quickly come back in again. I've just had a quick chat with the team from Matthias Rostagny. Thanks for the good news. He's perfectly okay. Just a slight bang to his right wrist. Other than that, he's absolutely A-okay.
Oh, that's great news. Thanks, Matt. We have then got these final results from this race then. That is a result. Samuel Eboldi takes the win then. He'll be moving up to race one with Jaden Fernandez from the Mini GP North America. Matthias Rostagny did finish in third there. Blake Wilson fourth. Frié fifth. Poutre, Shedden, Haffey and Izhdar there in P9. So, I mean, it's a pretty close race considering everything that went on there.
Yeah,
then you have Brian Hamilton from the Mini GP Ireland behind Flyer, and then Kenzie and Matsudaira in 12th. Joshua Williams, Finn and Verity, Giacominino, and also Vicente bringing up the rear in P16.
Yeah, so Enzo Giacomino is not the Frenchest of names, is it?
No.
It's an absolutely spectacular name.
I mean, yeah.
But it's one where you have to check the flag.
He's got a Ferrari F1 driver all over him with that sort of name, isn't he?
For sure. Career change.
Yeah, absolutely. So, no, well done to all those riders. The top, everyone other than the top two, that is their day finished pretty much. We are going to actually go head down to Parc-Fermé then. So, we'll get to speak to the first place rider, Samuel Eboldi. Well then, these are the highlights then. I guess we're not going to speak to Sam Welly, bless him, so we can see the highlights from this qualifying race one here at the Circuit Ricardo Tormo. We do have these highlights coming up, and then we'll have a 20-minute break before the next race. Myself and Fran, we're going to have an understandably well-earned rest, frankly. You can see all the moves, the audacious moves that are being put on the rider's head. That was the number 16, Frié, the Frenchman trying to make a move on there, and this was where the race came to a head. Big crash for Rostagny there into the final corner, but fortunately you can see there, relatively low impact and all okay, and just, well, unfortunately took out another Frenchman there, did he, at the end there. That would have been, I'm not quite sure. It wasn't a 3-8, so it'd be the other French rider. We'll see you in about 20 minutes.
Since many years ago, we started the road to MotoGP. We started in FIA and CEP, then we do the different talent caps, but we realized that was a gap in the lower age.
And for many years, we have been trying to come up with a format that would be suitable at all levels in all countries.
So for the kids between 10 and 14 years old, we have put on the move this year the Mini GP FIM World Series.
With the collaboration of Ovale, which made a bike that was great for this type of ages, we developed these series, which makes it affordable and easy for federations around the globe to have their own national, regional, or continental championships, which will then lead into a final, which would give us the champion every year.
This is the first step. Then you have the FIMSEV, you have the Red Bull Rookies Cup, we have all the Talents Cup in all over the world, and then we start the stairs from Moto3, Moto2, MotoGP. This is the aim. Some years of experience, of fighting, of some sacrifices, but also some glory. And this is what we want, starting with the 10 years old in Mini-GP.
We have national, continental, or regional series. These are all at the same level, so they can be an FIM MiniGP North America Series, which is a continental series, but there's also the FIM MiniGP Italy Series, which is a national series. But they are all at the same level, and they all have access to the final, which will take place every year in the last round of the MotoGP Championship. This year, for example, we have 10 cups around the globe, 10 series around the globe, that will take part in the final. Out of these 10 cups, the top three of each cup will have access to this final, in which there will be free practice, qualifying, and five races with a super final race. And here, the champion of the FIM MiniGP World Series will be awarded.
The winner of this competition will be subsidized by us, by the championship, to grow in another specialty to try to continue his career. And maybe we can have, not just for the winner, to try to understand exactly where are the others and try to help them also.
We will have ambassadors selected from either MotoGP, Moto2 or Moto3, the one that is most adequate to the nationality of the riders, that will be present at the final with the riders, and they will be helping them race during those days. So basically, it's kind of a position as a mentor, as a coach also.
To have a role model, a hero, to be there, to see, look, you can be like me.
And as many MotoGP riders already train with these Ovale bikes, they know how to use them. So it will be a great help for the MiniGP riders to get feedback from the MotoGP riders.
I think we have started in the right foot. We are doing well, the kids love it, and we are having wonderful competition.
It's going very well, it's going very well. I have information from the National Federation that is a lot of interest to see how good they are.
Everybody is very, very positive. 2022, we have already confirmed 14 countries, but I would like to have at least in the near future between 25, 30 countries going, so that we have one champion in Valencia from each country. This is the aim, this is our objective.
The cups in 2022 will be basically the same as for 2021, just we'll need to have a minimum of 5 events and 10 races. Those that have their championships already established this year will continue next year, and we are hoping to get more.
Our idea is to make this championship stable and to do it next year and the years after, and also every year with the experience of the year before, to try to improve the quality of the championship.
So it's for the first time MiniGP FIM World Cup in Czech Republic. It is an Alpe Adria series, so the Central European series. We are very proud to host this event, and we are glad that we can join it to the MiniGP Czech Championship. Thank you very much, everybody, for coming, and we hope to have some champions for next year.
All the riders for being here at Cartagena Cab with the spectacular race. Next time we will meet at Vransko, Slovenia for the third round of FIM MiniGP Alpe Adria Series. Bye!
Ciao a tutti, mi chiamo Samuele Baldi e finalmente sono riuscito a vincere una gara dell'Alpe Adria Series con la mia ovale 160 e le impressioni sulla pista mi è piaciuta tanto la pista. E abbiamo vinto gara 1 e gara 2 battagliando con Mazzò Masili che faccio i complimenti e in gara 2 è stato molto bravo a sorpassarmi dopo un mio errore e purtroppo all'ultimo giro è caduto e sono riuscito a vincere anche in gara 2 e poi la pista mi è piaciuta molto quindi ho cercato sempre di migliorare sempre di più passo passo. E ringrazio la mia famiglia, i miei sponsor e mio padre che mi ha sostenuto tutto quanto il weekend e mi ha risolto tutti gli errori. Ciao a tutti.
This weekend, I heard your friends come over. They congratulated you. What are these moments like?
I mean, it was my first time actually winning. But this year, with all the training in Europe, it's an unspeakable feeling. This was way more than I expected it to be.
We'll be right back.
was a very close race. Nathan and Jaden were right behind me. That just kept my pace up.
In 160 class, it was a really close battle. I knew I still needed to push, otherwise they would catch me. It was a great race, very close.
The first FIM Mini GP World Series final will take place during Valencia GP Race Week, and here's everything you need to know about it. Vale GP0160s are the two-wheeled machines that will guide the next generation of young talent onto the world stage. The top few riders from each of the 10 FIM Mini GP series from around the world will converge on Valencia. At the heart of the world final format is the group lottery, consisting of three groups, A, B and C. Each group will have four free practices, with the aim being to set as fast a time as possible. Based on those times, the bottom 12 will head to Q1, the middle 10 will head to Q2, and the top 8 riders will qualify directly for Q3. The 12 riders in qualifying 1 will battle for 4 spots that will see them advance through to Q2. The same principle is then applied to Q2, as this time 14 riders will battle it out for the top 4 spots. After all that, we end up with 12 riders vying for pole position in qualifying 3, which will set the rest of the grid for Thursday's races. In qualifying race 1, the bottom 18 from qualifying practice will prepare to do battle. No championship points are up for grabs here, but the top two finishers will secure themselves a place in race one, along with the fastest 12 from qualifying practice, where championship points are indeed up for grabs. Qualifying race two is much the same as qualifying race one, but this time 16 riders will battle it out for just one spot that will see them transfer into race two. The top 15 of the championship after race two will race in the super final, where double points will be on offer. The rider with the most points after that will be crowned the winner and become the first FIM Mini GP World Series champion.
Sono i quadrati.
Hi. Cool. Okay. Hello then, welcome back to the FIM Mini GP World Series final here from the Ricardo Tormo circuit in Valencia. Myself, Matt Dunn, with you for commentary. Alongside me, Fran Wild. We have Matt Burt down in pit lane, and this is race one coming your way. A little bit different than the qualifying race, Fran. Let's talk about it. What's different this time?
What's different is points. We've got points up for grabs in this one. Normal point scoring system for those of you who are more from the MotoGP school. Our friends on four wheels are a little different. But so it's 25, 20, 16, so on and so forth. So and then at the end, obviously, the rider with the most points at the end of all the races will be the champion. But there's double points in the super final race. And then the quote-unquote normal point system for this race one and race two a little bit later on as well. So the stakes are a little bit higher now and it's really starting to hot up. And we have the top two from qualifying race one joining this race, which was Samuele Baldi and Jadon Fernandez, who came through in that one.
We have riders heading to the grid now, so I think it's probably a good time to pass down to our roving pit lane reporter, Matt Burt, see how everyone's feeling ahead of race one and if he's got anyone with him.
Yeah, I have indeed, yeah, Matt. Thanks again. Down in pit lane, I'm delighted to say I'm joined by a Portuguese racing here, Miguel Oliveira, trying to unearth a Portuguese star of the future. Miguel, I know you've got big interest in developing young talent back at home in Portugal. How are your guys feeling ahead of this big day?
Well, they were, I think, now a little bit more nervous. No, but all good. I mean, they are familiar with the competitive environment. Some of them already raced in Spain a couple of mini GP races. And they three of them came through the Oliveira Cup program, which is nice. They are familiar with this bike, so it is a pleasure to see them competing here in the finals, and hopefully they'll make it far.
It is a huge day in their careers and in their lives. So what advice have you been able to pass on? You've done it before. You're a Moto3 winner, Moto2 winner. You've won in MotoGP as well. So what advice have you been able to give the guys ahead of this weekend?
I think it's very hard to give advice to kids because each of them see the competition in a different way. Some of them don't feel pressure at all, and they are super fun, and they take it quite light. Some others realize, you know, here, you know, even if you are 12, some of them think already different than an 11-year-old, and you know, age here is a huge thing, and
they mature different. So it's hard to sometimes give the same advice to everyone. And this is what I've come to learn in Portugal, working with the kids. It's quite hard to please.
Great to hear from Miguel. Enjoy the day.
Yes, thank you.
Yeah, thanks very much, Matt. And Miguel Oliveira, keep an eye out for two of his riders in this race coming up now. Pedro Matos and Martin Reis starting from P10 and P12 on this grid here today. Great to see so many ambassadors here as well. Fran de Sor, Joe Roberts there, also Sergio Garcia, who's not an ambassador. Miguel Oliveira obviously is. The riders absolutely love it. And I think they all came down to see it. They all loved it because they're thinking, God, if this was around when I was growing up racing, wow.
Yeah, I think for Miguel, obviously, he's put a lot into creating more kind of interest and opportunity for motorcycle racing in Portugal. So for him, yeah, for sure, it's a really important thing. And then obviously Joe Roberts, he's the North America Series ambassador. And likewise, there's been a mini GP series in the States for a while, but this is the first year of the new FIM Mini GP World Series. So by definition, the first year that the official North America Series is joining us. But yeah, it's great to see so much interest, like you say. And also like Sergio Garcia, I think Johan Zarco is down there somewhere as well. We've had a lot of the MotoGP photographers going down, taking interest again, not for paid employment reasons, just because they're really interested in checking it out and seeing what's going on down there. So it's really great, the level of interest.
Guys, I'll just quickly butt in because I've got an interested spectator down here. We've got one Czech rider in this race that's coming up today, a Spanacek. I'm delighted to say Czech rider Filip Salac is here to lend some support to him. Your thoughts pre-race here, Filip, on your boys' prospects?
We will see, but I saw yesterday he was quite fast, and I wish him good luck. And yeah, it's a nice project. I see it today for the first time, and it's very nice that they made this for small kids. It looks like here like a world championship, but it's world championship, you know. But yeah, it looks very good, and I think it's really good for new generation riders.
Good stuff. Enjoy the race.
Thanks.
Thank you very much, Matt and Filip Salac there. Filip Salac supporting the number 13, Tadeusz Benesek, the Czech rider from the MiniGP Alp Adria region there.
Yes, indeed. And we did see as well another member of the racing royalty from the MotoGP paddock and worldwide, really, down there. Okay, so first I'll change that to Johan Zarco. You can see Pramac Racing's Johan Zarco. MotoGP multiple podium finisher and top independent team rider this year as well, wrapped up last time out. Great to see he's down there, I'm sure, sharing a few tips and tricks. And also FIM president George Viegas down there as well. Obviously, the FIM and Dorna, two of the real key forces behind this, and it's great to see so many people down there on there and showing their support.
Yeah, Fran, you just quickly mentioned Johan Zarco, a Pramac Ducati MotoGP star, of course. I'm delighted to say I managed to grab a quick word with Johan. Johan, your first chance to look at this FIM Mini MotoGP series. What do you make of it?
I like it. I've been working with the children for a few years. Then now, the last 3 years, I was more focused on what I have to do. But clearly, I'm kind of sensitive about what can come next and the best method to bring the riders at the, I would not say the lowest cost as possible, but something quite stable where you can learn and grow up as a rider and don't think only about the material. And these kind of bikes, I think they have a good balance for it. And the good thing is that the adult or the big rider, they can ride on it, and it's even still, they have a good performance for the adult and for the children. So as a MotoGP rider, if you take it, you can show good things to the young rider, and then when the children, they saw you, they want to copy and follow you, so they can grow up so quick like this. And I think that's why I'm here, just to watch a bit this organization and try to have the same in France, because for the tarmac category, we are a bit weak in France, and now with Fabio and me, we need to use this moment to make the France grow up a bit as Spain and Italy.
Perfect. Great to hear from you, Joe, and enjoy the racing.
Merci.
Thank you very much, Matt and Johan Zarco. Also, I just want to give a quick shout out there to Josh O'Brien, the only rider I saw on that grid taking off his own tyre warmers. Top lad!
love that. So we'll be getting the warm-up lap underway then. We did see the grid graphic, but just as a quick refresher, the front row is a Mini GP Spain lockout. out. It's Izan Rodriguez Alvarez, Pablo Oliveras Rodriguez, and Alberto Enriquez Ortega. And then Josh O'Brien, yep, Irish rider, heading up the second row ahead of Eduardo Liguori and Matteo Missili, who are both Italian, but from the Italy and Alp Adria series. Then a couple more Italians with Gabriel Fabio Vuono and Christian Borelli. And then we've got Ruben Nyland, the top mini GP Netherlands rider, Pedro Matos from the Portuguese series, and then Tadej Benacek and Martin Reich, like we said, on the back of those from Q3. And then our top two riders who've just come through from qualifying race one.
Yep, so cannot wait for this one then. This is points on the boards for these riders. Do I see one of the mini GP Spain, two of the mini GP Spain riders right at the back there? So they're going to be doing a little bit of cheeky little mind games already, just weaving through from the back of the grid, coming through to that front row, I think. Teaming in confidence. But the number 22 there off, Josh O'Brien, leading the pack through to the final corner to line up on the grid then. So we saw it got a bit dramatic in the qualifying race not too long ago. This is race one. There are points available. And, well, this is the World Series final. There is the number 44, Ethan Alvarez, the cut above the rest, fastest in the combined free practice classifications as well by a tenth of a second, and took pole position for this first race yesterday by nearly 0.4 of a second. That was the biggest gap throughout.
It was, yeah. Impressive performance from the number 44 with a few tips from the MotoGP number 44. Here we go then. It's time for race one.
Yep, lights are on and out they go. And we're racing here in the FIM Mini GP World Series for the second time here today. And it's a great start for all three Spanish riders for taking through the turns one, two and three. All cleanly through. And it is Alvarez out front, the number 44. But which one is he followed by? I can't quite read the numbers on the side there.
Is it Italian? Is it Irish? I'm not quite sure in the lights that we've got.
It's three Spanish kids, but we've got...
And then it's the number 26. So it's Eduardo Liguori who's moved through then into fourth place. But like you said, good start for all the Spanish kids. Second and third, a little bit close off the line, but great start for Ethan Rodriguez from pole position, and he's well away in the lead then. And reminder, this is for points and a podium now, so high stakes.
Yeah, let's not get confused. You got Ethan Rodriguez Alvarez, and then you got Pablo Oliveras Rodriguez, the number 46 as well.
Yep.
So
double surname, yeah. Life.
Oh dear. So I think it's actually the number 46, which is Oliveras Rodriguez, who's actually in second place behind Ethan.
Yes, I think it is as well.
Yeah, there we are.
So, yeah, you can clearly see those three Spanish flags there at the front. Good stuff in there. And we've got the graphics up then as well. So it is Liguori who's moved into fourth, just ahead of O'Brien from the Ireland then, just losing out one spot there. But good stuff so far. Nice, clean getaway once again for race one.
Yeah, and a little reminder as well. These lap times are around about 46 seconds long. 10 lap races for races one and two, and also the qualifying one. But it's the super final, which is a little bit longer, isn't it?
It is, yeah. That's 15, the super final, so that should be interesting stuff later on over a little bit longer race distance, because we even saw in qualifying race one that as the race went on, we had one rider catching another in the latter stages of that. So yeah, can all change, but at the moment it is all Spain in this race. They've really dominated so far.
Ooh, bit of a moment had a bit there of a bubble for, there coming through turn four.
Yeah, most definitely, but held it together then, and managing to pull away at the moment from the rest. Really, really impressive from the young Irish rider to have stayed where he more or less where he was on the grid. And then we've got a bit of an Italian battle behind them, I think.
Yeah, that is Massili, the number 11 there, leading that sort of second pack or so, but it's a Spanish trio out front. I mean, you could say, oh, they're on home soil or whatever, but oh, that's a bit of a bubble there for the number 46, but he just holds off. There's a compatriot just behind him there, towards the final corner. These bikes, they are difficult. They're really worthwhile having, because they can be quite difficult to ride, but they're like the best things for these young riders to actually have. They can be quite twitchy when they get unstable. It teaches you so many different skills, doesn't
it? Yeah, you're definitely learning properly how to ride. It's not just like sit down and basically full gas and then just point it in the right direction.
Gears as well, four-speed gearbox.
Yeah, exactly. It's definitely the best kind of challenge to really learn and progress, and also pretty fun to race as well. I think lots of good reviews from those who maybe aren't in the series but also just really want to be now.
Yeah, a little worthwhile reminder as well. These ones are the 160cc Ovale machines. They're the GP0s. They've got a 10-inch wheelbase. There is actually the GP2s, which is a bit bigger, 12-inch wheelbase, same cc's, 4-speed gearbox, and those are the ones that you see often GP riders using for training. So they are a bit bigger, hence... well, full-grown adults can actually ride these bikes.
Full-grown adults, indeed.
And me. that was a bobble there. Sorry, into turn five.
I was trying to decide which one of us I roast, basically. Oh,
it's
Massilli
who's gone down. Oh, dearie me. So that's his race over and done with. Unable to get it going again. That's a shame. He was leading the sort of second group there. Not sure if we'll have a replay, but six laps to go. That's him out of contention, unfortunately, for this one.
Yeah, unfortunately it is. So let's try and have a look then behind the top three, just what we're looking at the moment. I think we've still got O'Brien in fourth place, but he seems to have a little bit closer company than he had before. So that could get interesting. And we can also see as well, Ethan Rodriguez in the lead has started to pull out a little bit more of a gap. They're a little bit more evenly spaced now at the front, and here we go then, who's in fourth and fifth?
The number 26 of Liguori from Mini GP Italy, who's actually made it in front of O'Brien there. So these two are having a great little fight for fourth.
They are indeed. So yeah, nice close racing between these guys, and good progress from Liguori then, just to get ahead of O'Brien. We'll have to see then who is going to come out on top in this. There's still quite a few laps to go.
Yeah,
it's by no means over yet, so let's keep an eye on that. But at the moment, this race is well controlled by Ethan Rodriguez.
To see there also on the timing screens, very briefly, the number 25 of Buono, the fellow Mini GP Italy rider, up there into sixth place, I think it was. Sixth place, that would make sense, wouldn't it? Before the timing tower left us very briefly. But it's still all to play for with the Spaniards out front, though. Just looks like the number 45 just sitting there rather comfortably as we see Marcel Schrotter and Tom Lutie here watching on.
Yeah, most definitely. It's great to see so many people here, and not many of them aren't in an official capacity as an ambassador. They just want to have a look and check it out and enjoying it. So that's really good stuff. At the moment it's a bit of a Spain show, isn't it? But I'm sure we'll get a bit more soon. We've got Bertie down in pit lane, possibly trying to talk to us, or have we got a microphone crackle? Maybe not. It must just be
I thought we had our roving reporter chiming in there as we're looking at this battle between O'Brien and Liguori heat up a little bit. A bit of a mistake there, I think, for O'Brien into those first S's there. They're quite difficult to get right because the UK Ovale dealer, some of you may or may not know him. He's just the fastest rider around the Isle of Man TT. It's Peter Hickman. He's here this weekend giving plenty of riders lots of tips. He was saying the main line you have got at all was that was O'Brien. Ooh. Had a big moment coming out of there. You've got to take quite a lot of curb in there, and you've got to accelerate on the way in through those chicanes. If you're trying to weave in and out and not take the curb, you're putting a lot more force and effort through the bike, and it's not actually the fastest line. That was a big mistake going into the final.
Very wide there from Liguori. Yeah.
Wow.
So it's as you were then from a few laps ago, and O'Brien back in front then in the battle for fourth. So both of those guys then had a little bit of a moment. They're obviously really pushing on, but great stuff so far. Good battle from those two. And who is just behind them now? Is Buono still, isn't it? I think he's got some company though, and that gap is coming down a bit.
Replay. Nearly lost the front then, I suppose, into that is turn 14. So same as on the actual Grand Prix circuit, that kind of corner. But then this one leads into an S's there to make the straight a little bit shorter to give the runoff more opportunity to do its thing into the actual turn one.
Yep, exactly. So, it's interesting, though, at the front, that gap's definitely come down for Ethan Rodriguez. He's got a shadow now right on his tail. So this could get pretty interesting then. I think we're on to the last lap as well.
Yeah.
So where are we going to see a move? Is one going to come?
46 versus 44. Well then, so last lap, here we are coming down sort of the back straight, as it were, in towards turn eight. That's one overtaking opportunity gone. Easy on the gas for Ethan, who has been fastest in both free practice and qualifying. Pablo Rodriguez just behind him. He's going to try and make a move into this final turn, but is it too little too late?
I think it is. I don't think he's going to be quite close enough, but certainly putting the law.
Maybe not though. He squares it off. No chance as he's coming out the final corner. No slipstream, unfortunately, for them. Is that not the final lap? Well, the graphic's wrong then. So
maybe the graphic's wrong. Okay,
that's
then.
This is the penultimate lap.
We're going to find out then in a minute. So see when that finish flag comes out. Then. We've got another few meters then to go and see this battle rage on. He's been getting closer and closer, but
I'm glad the riders are aware of how many laps you are to go at least, because we're not apparently. So there we are, number 44 versus 46 continues for maybe one more lap. Here
maybe
we are,
one
the
more
final
lap,
sort of sector then, this long turn 13.
And we've also had a crash, I think, for number 45. So that's one of the Spanish riders. That's Alberto Enriquez Ortega. So it's not going to be a Spanish lockout, but it is going to be a Spanish 1-2. Amazing close finish then between those two guys, Ethan Rodriguez and Pablo Olivares. And then for third place, it is then, I think, Italian, was it?
I think it was Liguri.
Was it Italian
who got the
ahead
better
of Irish?
I think it was Liguri who got the better of O'Brien at the end there. So, yeah, a real shame for, I think it was Ortega you mentioned, yeah, crashed out there. Third place all race long and then crashed out. What have you got for us,
just
Matt?
Just right at the end.
Happy that the FIM makes these championships, and yeah, it's really good to come to MotoGP.
It looks like a couple of those Spanish riders out there might be giving you a hard time in a few years' time.
Yeah, the Spanish riders are really good. Yeah, that's all.
Thanks a lot, Sergio. Enjoy the weekend. Back to you guys.
Well then, thank you very much, Sergio Garcia. Then, so Ethan Rodriguez does take the win then from Pablo Olivares. A great race between the two there. I mean, well, got to hand it to him. I mean, Spain absolutely crushing the road to MotoGP game at the moment. I mean, such strong riders throughout
Indeed.
Every class.
Yeah. So yeah, impressive stuff though. But I mean, it's also useful. This must be the aftermath, I think, then of the crash. Yeah.
For Ortega. For Enriquez. Yeah.
Enriquez, sorry.
Yeah, so well, the thing is, on our result sheets, you've got all three names for the Spanish riders here, and okay, I thought it was, well, obviously in UK names, it's a middle name, but there
we're
we
gonna
are.
We're going to go, much like the man we just spoke to, Sergio Garcia Dolz, he gets called Garcia.
Yeah,
we're
going to
go for the first surname.
Yeah. It's not like Marc Marquez Alenta, isn't it? It's Marc Marquez. So, yeah, there we are.
Branding.
Yep, here we go. So, Ethan Rodriguez takes the win. No Parc Fermé is... as such, but that was Alberto Enriquez coming back in. We are going to get the podium in this one as well, though, which is exciting. First ever podium in the FIM Mini GP World Series final. And we'll be having dignitaries up on the podium as well, won't we, Fran? So it really is just Mini MotoGP throughout in every single aspect of it.
It really is, yeah. And we've got, I think we're going to get national anthem, we've got dignitaries, we've got everything, really, except Prosecco.
Might have a fruit shoot or something. Sparkling water. And the families and fans in the grandstand giving a good cheer on there from the Motorcycle Union of Ireland. So no doubt cheering on Josh O'Brien as the riders come through towards the Mini Parc Fermé. It's just representation throughout, isn't there? So people from all corners of the MotoGP World Championship coming down to see us, because these are, you know, potentially the stars of the future. Nothing's ever a guarantee, but if you're in the FIM Mini GP World Series final, you're going a long way to improving your future. Oh, wow, we just actually had confirmation then. So it was Josh O'Brien who made it into third place at the end of that one then. Oh, no, that's not the right graphic. He's not crashed. So, yeah, there he is. He's in Parc Fermé. Great stuff for Mini GP Ireland then. And there's their unofficial ambassador, Cormac Ryan Meenan.
their unofficial ambassador. And, MotoGP photographer, so you can get some good content from that. So, yeah, I think then we did have an extra lap there. And the graphic
okay,
was correct, so
yeah.
We're going back.
So we were
to
correct.
Lap 10. We were.
The riders
vindication.
Were wrong.
Vindication. So yeah, I think it is then Josh O'Brien then actually on the podium for Ireland. So we've got Spain, Ireland.
Yeah.
Would you have called that on Tuesday?
No,
I would not. I'm very impressed.
I'm sure the Irish ambassador, Brad Binder, will be very, very happy with that. I'm not joking. Brad Binder, the South African, was nominated as the Irish ambassador. Obviously no Irish riders in the MotoGP well, world championship, really.
Yeah, no. So we needed a native English speaker who's willing to give up some of their time and help the guys out a little bit until we do get more of an Irish presence on the world stage.
We got Cormac. Just get Cormac. He's taking the photos.
He would definitely be very keen to be able to ride one of these, I'm very sure.
Well, I'm sure if you look close enough, if he disappears off the grid for the next race, he's probably donned some leathers and trying to have a go himself. It's the fourth entry. But yes, there we have it. So, not controversy at the end of one, but just a bit of confusion. Commentators were right. See, commentators are always right.
I mean, don't say that. That sets us up for much failure in the coming races.
Well, I mean, we couldn't get the names right earlier several times. So
it was the checkered flag then. It was just a little bit later than it should have been. But we do then get an Irish podium. So that's very exciting as a start for the Irish series.
So Pablo Olivares is second place officially and started second on the grid, finished second in the race. Ethan Rodriguez was your winner. So that was that was a great race, wasn't it, Fran? I mean,
it was a good little race.
Yeah.
Absolutely, yeah. So a bit of a heartbreaker for Alberto Enriquez there with a late crash, but some good speed at least that he'll be happy with, I'm sure.
But did he crash on the extra lap though?
No, I don't think
it was before
that. It was a little bit before.
Well,
I was just waiting to chip in with that information because we don't have the full live timing screen, so we're a little bit different. There's Blake Wilson then sticking around to have a look until he hopefully gets back out there for a qualifying.
Are we having this podium then, or
we are? I'm sure we are.
Some point soon, hopefully.
See a lot of familiar faces down there from MotoGP. It's really great. Lots of interest.
Yes, this is the thing, though, isn't it? As I mentioned briefly earlier, I mean, what? This is such a sort of perfect kind of idea, perfect way to sort of find the talent from the future from all over the world, isn't it? I mean, with that parity you mentioned earlier, what better way can you do that to really find the talent of the future in MotoGP?
Exactly, and also kind of fill in that gap between sort of pocket bikes and then sort of the Moto3 machinery that they go to in talent cups. I was talking to Zulfami Khairuddin, obviously knows a thing or two about racing. He's with the Malaysia series, and he was saying for them it's really, really great because it does kind of fill a gap that they had previously, and it also is providing opportunities to move up and creating a bit of a better paced ladder, especially for countries like Malaysia next year. The Australia series joins, also the North America series, where sometimes it's just a little bit more difficult to get on the ladder at the right time, but with the age limits raising, the Mini GP World Series kind of plugging that gap in the middle and trying to create those equal opportunities and really cost effective ones as well.
Yeah,
it should be good news.
This is the thing about these bikes, aren't they? Back in the day, it was all about mini motors, but these are a step above. So credit to the guys who are like the dealers, even all the dealers who are here sorting people out. You've got Peter Hickman from the UK, the UK dealer. You've got Brandon Cretu from the former road racer as well. He's the North American dealer. He's here supporting his riders. It's great to see them also hands on. I mean, you've got racing royalty throughout, haven't you?
You have, and a little bit on the screen there on the right, Loris Caparossi still down there enjoying the Mini GP World Series. So let's see then, we're waiting for the podium. Of the 2021 and there we go, Matt Burt's dulcet tones announcing the podium. Place, I feel replaced.
Number 22 from Ireland, Josh O'Brien.
Yeah, Josh O'Brien comes out onto the podium then, perhaps slightly unexpectedly, but that is a cracking result for the Irishman there. Good on him. They'll be having second place.
Welcome to Spain's Pablo Olivares.
Pablo Olivares then, he'll be chuffed with that. For all the way to the line, maybe he'll manage to get your winner, Ethan Rodriguez, in one of the following races.
Winner from Spain, Ethan Rodriguez.
We are going to get the full podium experience, like you said, dignitaries.
Presenting the third place trophy is Fabrizio Dottavi, Group Power Sports Communication Manager for Motul.
Well, I think you can hear Matt so loud and clear, we don't really need to commentate the podium, do we, to be honest?
I'm just listening to him, really. Nice little trophy there.
Motul's Mr. Dottavi.
So, Motul, obviously the lubricant supplier for the series. You can see the logo in the background.
Giorgio Barbier.
There you are.
And then I believe it's, Pirelli presenting the winner. And then we'll get the national anthem.
The national anthem of Spain. Thank you.
Well, there we are then. So, national anthem of Spain. That must be a very, very special feeling for Ethan Rodriguez. And of course, we will do it all again several times over the rest of
the
day.
We need that. Yeah, I was going to say, we need to turn that cap round. Come on, keep to the protocol. So that was a great race then, and we'll be back soon enough with another.
Yeah, these are then the final results. Ethan Rodriguez takes the win ahead of Pablo Olivares. Josh O'Brien in third place from Eduardo Liguori. Gabriel Fabio Buono in fifth place from Pedro Matos. Great ride by the Portuguese rider. Coming up from, I think that was 10th on the grid, wasn't it? That's pretty impressive. Borelli,
yeah,
Nichland and Banatek are there in ninth place. Rice, Baldi, Fernandez, and then Enriquez, well, technically remounted and finished. The only non-finisher technically, but did finish in the results sheet. Matteo Missili crashed earlier on.
He did, yeah. So good stuff, and points on the board for many now. And then we'll be coming back again soon enough with another qualifying race.
Yeah, absolutely. We'll be getting a look at the highlights very shortly then. Cracking first race here. Well, official race one. Of course, up next we will have qualifying race two. The winner from that will be in the official race two, and potentially going to the super final as well. What a ride this has been. Well, don't go anywhere, because in around about 20 minutes time or so, we'll be back with you, bringing you all the coverage from qualifying race two. Catch you then.
Since many years ago, we started the Road to MotoGP. We started in FIM-CEP, then we do the different talent caps, but we realized that was a gap in the lower age.
And for many years, we have been trying to come up with a format that would be suitable at all levels in all countries.
So for the kids between 10 and 14 years old, we have put on the move this year the Mini GP FIM World Series.
With the collaboration of Ovale, which made a bike that was great for this type of ages, we developed these series, which makes it affordable and easy for federations around the globe to have their own national, regional, or continental championships, which will then lead into a final, which would give us the champion every year.
This is the first step. Then you have the FIM-CEV, you have the Red Bull Rookies Cup, we have all the Talents Cup in all over the world, and then we start the stairs from Moto3, Moto2, MotoGP. This is the aim. Some years of experience, of fighting, of some sacrifices, but also some glory. And this is what we want, starting with the 10 years old in Mini-GP.
We have national, continental, or regional series. These are all at the same level, so there can be an FIM Mini-GP North America series, which is a continental series, but there's also the FIM Mini-GP Italy series, which is a national series. But they are all at the same level, and they all have access to the final, which will take place every year in the last round of the MotoGP championship. This year, for example, we have 10 cups around the globe, 10 series around the globe that will take part in the final. Out of these 10 cups, the top three of each cup will have access to this final, in which there will be free practice, qualifying, and five races with a super final race. And here, the champion of the FIM Mini GP World Series will be awarded.
The winner of this competition will be subsidized by us, by the championship, to grow in another specialty to try to continue his career. And maybe we can have, not just for the winner, to try to understand exactly where are the others and try to help them also.
We will have ambassadors selected from either MotoGP, Moto2 or Moto3, the one that is most adequate to the nationality of the riders, that will be present at the final with the riders, and they will be helping them race during those days. So basically, it's kind of a position as a mentor, as a coach also.
To have a role model, a hero, to be there, to see, look, you can be like me.
And as many MotoGP riders already train with these Ovale bikes, they know how to use them. So it will be a great help for the MiniGP riders to get feedback from the MotoGP riders.
I think we have started in the right foot. We are doing well, the kids love it, and we are having wonderful competition.
It's going very well, it's going very well. I have the information from the National Federation that is a lot of interest to see how good they are.
Everybody is very, very positive. 2022, we have already confirmed 14 countries, but I would like to have at least in the near future between 25, 30 countries going, so that we have one champion in Valencia from each country. This is the aim, this is our objective.
The Cups in 2022 will be basically the same as for 2021, just we'll need to have a minimum of 5 events and 10 races. Those that have their championships already established this year will continue next year, and we are hoping to get more.
Our idea is to make this championship stable and to do it next year and the years after, and also every year with the experience of the year before, to try to improve the quality of the championship.
So it's for the first time MiniGP FIM World Cup in Czech Republic. It is an Alpe Adria series, so the Central European series. We are very proud to host this event, and we are glad that we can join it to the MiniGP Czech Championship. Thank you very much, everybody, for coming, and we hope to have some champions for next year. We'll be right back.
Thank you to all the riders for being here at Cartarena Cab with the spectacular race. Next time we will meet at Vransko, Slovenia for the third round of FIM Mini GP Alpe Adria Series. Bye!
Ciao a tutti, mi chiamo Samuele Baldi e finalmente sono riuscito a vincere una gara dell'Alpe Adria Series con la mia ovale 160 e le impressioni sulla pista mi è piaciuta tanto la pista. E abbiamo vinto gara 1 e gara 2 battagliando con Mazzò Masili che faccio i complimenti e in gara 2 è stato molto bravo a sorpassarmi dopo un mio errore e purtroppo all'ultimo giro è caduto e sono riuscito a vincere anche in gara 2 e poi la pista mi è piaciuta quindi ho cercato sempre di migliorare sempre di più passo passo e ringrazio la mia famiglia, i miei sponsor e mio padre che mi ha sostenuto tutto quanto il weekend e mi ha risolto tutti gli errori. Ciao a tutti.
Matsudera winning the 160 this weekend. I heard your friends come over. They congratulated you. What are these moments like?
I mean, it was my first time actually winning. But this year, with all the training in Europe, it's an unspeakable feeling. This was way more than I expected it to be.
l'Inter del campionato che va a Cristian Borrelli. Inno nazionale.
It was a very close race. Nathan and Jaden were right behind me. That just kept my pace up. The 160 class, it was a really close battle. I knew I still needed to push, otherwise they would catch me. It was a great race, very close.
The first FIM Mini GP World Series final will take place during Valencia GP Race Week, and here's everything you need to know about it. Vale GP0160s are the two-wheeled machines that will guide the next generation of young talent onto the world stage. The top few riders from each of the 10 FIM Mini GP series from around the world will converge on Valencia. At the heart of the world final format is the group lottery, consisting of three groups, A, B and C. Each group will have four free practices, with the aim being to set as fast a time as possible. Based on those times, the bottom 12 will head to Q1, the middle 10 will head to Q2, and the top 8 riders will qualify directly for Q3. The 12 riders in qualifying 1 will battle for 4 spots that will see them advance through to Q2. The same principle is then applied to Q2, as this time 14 riders will battle it out for the top 4 spots. After all that, we end up with 12 riders vying for pole position in qualifying 3, which will set the rest of the grid for Thursday's races. In qualifying race 1, the bottom 18 from qualifying practice will prepare to do battle. No championship points are up for grabs here, but the top two finishers will secure themselves a place in race one, along with a fastest 12 from qualifying practice, where championship points are indeed up for grabs. Qualifying race two is much the same as qualifying race one, but this time 16 riders will battle it out for just one spot that will see them transfer into race two. The top 15 of the championship after race two will race in the super final, where double points will be on offer. The rider with the most points after that will be crowned the winner and become the first FAM Mini GP World Series champion.
Welcome back to the FIM MotoGP World Series, getting ready for qualifying race two. For everybody, had qualifying race one and the official race one, but what's different about this one?
So it's the top one heading through this time around. So everything at stake, but just not points. And we're going to make it a quick intro because we're going to pass down, hopefully, to our roving pit reporter, Matt Burt, with some MotoGP royalty down there in the mini-GP area. We can indeed, or I can certainly. Oh, apologies.
Also, they enjoy riding, which is the most important at this moment. But it's amazing, you know, just to come here to see these guys wearing the colors of each country. It's special. It's so nice.
And you've been in this position before, where you've dreams of being in MotoGP. You've got to realize your dreams. But what do you think these guys are going through? Because they're very, very young. It's a wonderful opportunity. I mean, how do you think the ability is to calm the nerves? Because you've been in this situation before yourself. Not easy.
Yeah, not easy. And especially, you know, because they paint the bikes as its country. And this gives an extra of pressure to them. Plus, you know, the MotoGP riders, we are appearing here, which some of us are their idols, as I had my idols when I was starting in this level. So, you know, the pressure for sure they have now, it's quite a lot. But even with that, they managed to ride fast, to do not crash, to finish the race. And at the end, they are young, and they need to enjoy what they are doing, and it looks like they are doing. So they have a good relationship between them. They are, like, not just competitors, they are friends as kids they are, and it's very nice. And, you know, it's like coming back in the past a little bit.
Well, it was great to hear from you, Paul. It looks like the future of Spanish racing talent is certainly in safe hands. Enjoy your day.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks Matt and Pol Espargaró. This is a thing, fan. I mean, Pol Espargaró said a couple of things there which I really enjoyed about it. The most important thing at the moment is they're enjoying themselves, these young riders. And then also, I mean, they get to literally interact with their idols before
going
out to race.
They really do. That was interesting as well. Just the other day, down at the Mini GP area, quite a few riders, like, who's your favourite rider? Fabio, Mark.
Mm.
Interesting generational.
They are born in like 2005 and 2007 and stuff.
It's bound to happen, but a bit of a changing of the guard there in the racing heroes.
So some of the youngest riders from the UK were born in 2011. That's when Casey Stoner won his last.
Exactly.
his last crazy title.
And Casey Stoner, to me, certainly still feels like he's one of the younger people in the paddock.
He's still a young whippersnapper.
It's great stuff, though, to see those guys all coming down to support and represent and give a few tips. Joe Roberts said yesterday, gained him half a second, didn't he?
Yeah, he did. He was giving a couple of the kids a bit of tips. And first of all, it was 2/10. Then kid gained half a second with his tips and stuff. Bless. Joe was one of those other riders who was literally down there all afternoon spending time with those with the young American kids, Jesse James Sheddon. Then you got Kienzie Matsudaira as well, and then also, of course, who is not in this race now, Jadon Fernandez.
Yeah, Jadon, who moved up after having been second in qualifying race one. So we can see, tantalisingly, reigning MotoGP world champion Fabio Quartararo at the front of the starting grid. Hopefully at some point we will get a few words from him, but he is down there anyway. He's also the French series ambassador. You see that monster logo in the middle of your screens. I believe that is the man of the moment, and Bertie's with him now as well, so we'll pass down to Fast Fabio and Matt Burt.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Fran. I am here with the current MotoGP world champion, of course, Fabio Quartararo. Fabio, great to see you coming down to support this this new initiative. What do you make of it so far?
Yeah, honestly, it's nice to see all these kids happy racing. I wish I had that when I was a child. So, really nice. Really looking forward to see the start and to finally look how good are these kids.
We saw you come down to the paddock about 10, 15 minutes ago. You're immediately mobbed. It's obvious that you are some of these guys' role models. So how is it important for you to be the MotoGP world champion and coming to support these guys?
It's important. I wish also when I was a kid to see all the MotoGP guys and to see how much support they can give you when I was a kid. So I think it's also a boost of energy for all these kids that see all the MotoGP guys feels great.
Enjoy the race. Never know, there might be another MotoGP world champion watching here today. So enjoy, Fabio.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Matt and Fabio Quartararo there. Absolutely echo all his sentiments completely. A bit of added extra pressure, though, Fran, isn't it? I mean, this is the thing. However, this is literally the best environment possible that they could have this amount of pressure on them, because we can't escape it. This is literally the biggest races, the biggest day of their lives so far.
It is indeed, yes. But in a good way, where everyone down there is definitely encouraging, enjoy what you're doing. Like Pol Espargaró, the important important thing is at this stage in your career is to enjoy the racing. And dealing with pressure is an important part of racing and in life as well. So, it's good stuff. But, yeah, it's definitely a very big day for those guys down there. And in the back you shot a minute ago, we also saw Enea Bastianini. So he's down there as well in his role as a Mini GP Italy Series ambassador. But here's the grid then for qualifying race two.
Jesse James Shedden on pole position ahead of Wilson. Blake Wilson, that is, saw him a little bit earlier. Then Rustagni, who had that crash earlier on, is actually in third position.
He is indeed. And then I think we should have Luca Freire, should we? And then Faris Butcher, Farish Hafi, Emil Iztar and Manny van Tilburg is sadly actually out of action today.
Yeah, broken finger, is
broken
it?
Broken finger, it seems, the Dutch rider from the Mini GP Netherlands series. Just in case anyone was tuning in from our friends in the Netherlands, unfortunately, one rider not taking part from that series today. And we also have a Brit on the sidelines as well. Before the event, Harley McCabe, winner of the UK series, sadly broke his wrist in training. So I think he's here, but he's not on track.
Oh, he's here,
so,
is he? Oh, that's nice.
Yeah, shame for him. Anyways. Also a racer in the BTC, so he could have been quite interesting to see the level, having also had top 10s in Talent Cup on a Moto3 machine. But, best wishes to him. Get well soon, and to Manny as well.
Because that's the sort of peripheral, sort of the excellent thing about this, isn't it? The riders not only get to come and they come and race at a MotoGP event, not on the full MotoGP circuit, but they're interacting with the riders. They're here for the weekend. They can see what they are able to achieve. I mean, what more motivation could you want?
Exactly. And there we have then Tom of Fabio fame joining Jake Dixon and his wife Sarah Dixon on the sidelines. Jake's the UK series ambassador. He came down to the track yesterday as well. So great to see so many of the guys coming down and taking an interest. That man we heard from on the broadcast earlier as well, Philip Salach. So it's really, really good stuff. They aren't just sitting on the sidelines watching. They have really been interacting a lot with these guys, especially throughout free practice and qualifying yesterday. And great to see Jake back down there again.
Limited advice, I suppose, they can give on a circuit that they've not really ridden before. Brand new surface as well. I guess they can give some sort of advice, but must be quite difficult for the riders.
Yeah, it's not the easiest, is it? So if I was you, riding this that I never have. it's good stuff there. You can see then, man of the moment, Fabio Quartararo.
I'm just thinking I would like to have been the part of the conversation whereby they told the safety car driver, you are driving the safety car at the Mini GP series. Oh yeah, are they on the big track?
No.
You are?
Yeah. I do love it. It's
sensational, isn't it? Jesse James Shedden got a little scuff on the front of his bike there. He accidentally clattered into one of the, I think it was the Spanish riders yesterday during one of the free practice sessions at the final corner. They just slowed up a little bit. Maybe they got a wobble on and he had nowhere to go, but all okay, fortunately. There is Wilson there, lined up. Blake Wilson ready to go as well. Proper little pocket rocket as well. All the riders are, aren't they, frankly? This is the Mini GP.
No pressure for him. He's one who said Fabio is one of his favourites, so Fabio is watching.
Yeah, well, there we go then. Lights are about to come on, and it's qualifying race two in the FIM Mini GP World Series. Here we go. Some big launches off there. I mean, some cracking wheelie jobs. There's Jesse James Shedden straight off like a shot. One place up for grabs in race two in the super final from this one.
Yeah, there is indeed. So winner takes all in this one, and Jesse James off to a great start. Blake Wilson as well, keeping that second place, so good job from him. Couple of wheelies, I think it was one of the Malaysian riders, got quite an interesting launch there, but no harm done. And then we've got France shadowing as well. I think that's Luca Freire, is it? France in third place at the moment. I think it's the number 16. No, it's the number 14. So it's Matthias Rustagni again, who almost managed to move through in qualifying race one.
Yeah, really did, but that was a big crash he had at the end then. So fortunately, he's absolutely fine and ready to go. This was the scene of the crash earlier on. Check out the line choices through the final chicane. So they really try and sort of straight line it going on to the start and finish straight, getting as much drive as possible. Don't want to be overtaken, of course. We're looking at the riders behind them there. Two Brits, and then you've got one of the Malaysians. Oh, we've got riders down there, have we? Two riders. Oh, I think that could be Kenze. Matsudaira's gone down there at the back, and with one of the Irish riders as well. Didn't quite see the number, though.
Yeah, not sure who that was there, but it definitely, it was a North America series rider, wasn't it? And an Irish flag that we saw on the other bike. So hopefully they're both okay. That's such bad luck for them in their possible.
Oh, we've got a red flag then. We have to make sure the track is clear and everything. So riders will be coming back down into pit lane and we'll have a restarted race. 9 laps to go at the end of that one. So red flag. Who's that? Another French rider who's gone down, is it? Whilst we got the red flag, we'll pass back down to Matt Burt, shall we? Matt Burt, what have you got for us?
Nothing at the moment.
Yeah, sorry, guys. I was just trying to find out where Jake Dixon is. He's just having a chat with Fabio. Come back to me in about 30 seconds, guys. I'll let those boys have their little nat and I'll interject shortly.
We'll try our best.
Good stuff, then. Hopefully, then, we will get to hear from Jake, who, like I said, is the UK Series ambassador. And this one, then, I'm sure we will get a restart because we were so early in the race.
Yeah.
So looks
cracking
like
start
then,
from Shedden, though, wasn't it?
Yeah, it really was. Really good under pressure, which is not an easy ask, especially at the race start. Because it's just one single moment where everything, the adrenaline spikes. So
we do have Kenzie sat up then, and who was that with him? Because that's a good sight to see.
It's definitely an Irish rider, isn't it? Or it was on the bike, I think. So they look pretty all right. I think probably just a little bit winded, and obviously in any coming together.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, let's pass back down to pit lane though, because I can see Matt Burt there. Who's he got for us now?
Yeah, thanks a lot, Matt. I am down here now, actually, with UK Mini GP ambassador Jake Dixon, who's soaking up the atmosphere down here. Jake, looks like you're enjoying it.
Yeah, honestly, it's amazing. It's a credit to Dorna to put this on, you know, for all the little kids. And yeah, I can't get over how young they are. When I first started road racing, I was 14, and some of these, the UK lads, one of them's the youngest at 10, and oh, it's unbelievable. But yeah, it's great to be here and great to show the support and give something back, you know.
And what about the three British lads that you're here supporting? We know you spent a lot of time down here in the paddock yesterday. Great work, mate. You're giving up some of your free time to come and help those guys out. What was impressive about the way that they go about their business?
Yeah, just for so young, they're so professional, you know. So, and it's such a nice thing to see. And I'll always give my time back. I always want to give back to the UK riders because as it is, we have it hard enough. So if I can give some knowledge back to them and try and help them out a bit, I'll always do it. So yeah, it's super nice and they're super talented. And yeah, it's just good to watch.
Awesome, mate. Enjoy your weekend. Thanks, Jake.
Well, thank you very much, Matt and Jake. There's we see Kenze being taken off. Did see him initially jog away, actually, from the crash. So hopefully get some good news after him being stretched away there. And then we saw Brian Hamilton had also crashed, but didn't look like the French rider had actually really got too involved in that. That was Lauke Frié, was it?
Yeah, not really sure. He was a little bit further over onto the right-hand side of the little replay that we did see of that. So not sure if he was definitely involved in the incident, but maybe just got clipped or something and didn't quite go down. But it did look like he got a couple of scuff marks as well. So not exactly sure how that happened, but it seems like most riders are more or less okay from that one. And hopefully we'll get the full clean bill of health very soon regarding Kenze.
Well, worth noting probably at the moment, the safety gear that the riders have, because I mean, so many partners involved in the FIM Mini GP World Series final here. Riders all got these KYT helmets, and then it's the virus leathers as well. I was hearing much about that. That's quite an impressive little project, that, by the leathers manufacturer, because, in fact, not leathers at all.
Well, I was going to say, really, the word you should be using is suits.
Yeah.
Because, yeah, they are they're vegan or certainly vegetarian. They're non-animal product. So, yeah, it's an interesting one. Quite a lot of innovation down there in Pit Lane.
You can wash them as well,
I
was told.
Yeah, so it's really interesting. And, yeah, great to have that support. And, of course, as well, if you're not aware, all of these guys have been able to, essentially, I wanted to use the phrase, although it was a little bit too informal for the press releases regarding it, rock up and race, because they've basically turned up and they've got a bike, they've got tools to use, they've got fuel, lubricants, they've also got the suits and a helmet supplied for them for this final. So especially those who are coming from a little bit further afield, like the North Americans and Malaysians, that's a pretty invaluable thing to be able to come here and then get that equal equipment and be able to race.
Yeah, really, really decent that. I mean, like we say, Jay Dixon was very complimentary about this, how it's sort of been set up and everything. We're going to get a replay of the start, are we? Yes. That was a massive leap put off the start there by one of the Malaysian riders. Not actually sure who that would have been. Would it have been Putra, the number 27? And then we have Matsidaira running off there after his accident.
Do you feel the front bouncing? Probably it's because of your riding style, because you let go of the brakes early and you're trying to ride.
Nice little
we can see
there.
You see Kenze Matsudaira walking back to his pit box then, now. So, yeah,
rider
that's great
okay
news.
Then from that. Also saw MotoGP journalist Elliot York in the background there as well, I think.
Shout out to Elliot doing all the interviews here. There he is. Elliot just walking there, going to check out all the garages.
As well.
I'll tell you what, I mean, it's quite interesting walk up a damn pit lane and looking in all the garages, because unlike MotoGP riders, Moto2 and Moto3, who are quite sort of coy in their reactions after a session, you can never really tell how they're feeling. These guys, these young riders,
full
are raw
gas.
Emotion. Yeah, if they're feeling that beat, they are like, woohoo! If they're not, you can tell.
Most definitely. But yeah, nice little debrief insight there that we got, just overhearing that. It was Blake Wilson, one of the UK series riders. And he was saying that when I had a catch up with him the other day, he's very aware of what the bike's doing and why, and seems to have a really good understanding of why he's gone faster or why he hasn't. And there is the aforementioned Jake Dixon down there with the UK series riders then at the box.
Yeah, Peter Hickman next to him as well.
I looked up a little bit too late to catch that.
Isle of Man TT legend, of course, doing the stuff here. I mean, he's been a big help on the young riders in the UK. Then you have Paul Espargaro there with, paddock legend Harry Lloyd as well, his press officer from Repsol Honda.
He'll love that mention, especially.
Hello, guys. Sorry to interject once again. I'm just walking down pit lane with a man who's keeping a very close eye on all the action. Just for your information, I think the pit lane opens in about 5 minutes' time for the grid to form for the restart. But I'm delighted to say I'm joined by a TT legend and a man who's got a big interest in this championship, Avali importer back in the UK and Ireland, Peter Hickman. Peter, this looks like an absolutely awesome...
Just a couple of little
tech problems there. Peter, like I say, it's such an incredible setup here in Valencia. You must be so delighted to be involved.
Absolutely, yeah. I mean, this whole setup that Dorna, the FIM, Vali, everybody that's put this effort and time, money, all the rest of it into this is absolutely fantastic. I've been the importer in the UK for a couple of years and into Ireland from the start of this year. And we have three guys here from Ireland and we've got three guys here from the UK. Unfortunately, Harley McCabe broke his radius a couple of weeks ago at a championship race, which is really unfortunate. I think he would have shown really, really well here this week. But that's the way things go. You know, our other couple of guys are doing really well. Blake's starting on the front row for this race. Josh is starting 8th, and the Irish kids 11th and 12th on the grid. And we've got Josh O'Brien, number 22, who you saw in the first proper championship race earlier, or point scoring race, finishing 3rd on the podium, which is absolutely awesome.
Sometimes the road to MotoGP, not the easiest route to take for British riders. We've seen that in the past, though. How important is this kind of setup to help the young lads that have clearly got the talent to potentially make it all the way and one day be fighting with the guys that we see around here, your Fabio Quartararo's and your Paul Espargaro's?
This is exactly what this is all about. You know, all these bikes are identical. There's nothing between any of them. Everything's been pulled out at random. And for me, this is what the biggest thing about Ovalle and their ethos about how they're producing these bikes and the championships that they want us to run to in all our different nations. They're really pushing that everyone's stock, everyone's sealed engines, everyone's got this, everyone's got that. So it's not about money, it's about who's actually got the talent. And for me, right from the start, the reason I got involved with this project a couple of years ago was all because of that, really, you know, because when I started, it wasn't like that, you know, and it does, you know, motorsport all the time depends on money to a certain degree. But here in this championship, pretty much anybody will be able to do it, and if they can do it and they've got the talent, they can definitely win.
Awesome to see you putting back into the sport we know you love so much, mate. Great to see you investing in future British talent as well. Keep up the good work, mate.
Thank you very much. Cheers.
Thank you very much, Bertie and Peter Hickman there. Seen another addition as well, as Aaron Canet has come down to check it all out as well.
I enjoyed that perfect reaction time from Fabio then, like, where? But we saw then Aaron down on the grid. So yes, great to see so many of these guys down here. Like we said, they don't have to be there. They're just taking a great interest in it. Mm. And Bertie was indeed correct when he said when pit lane would open. It's in a couple of minutes for us now that we'll be underway again. So it'll be original grid positions and 10 laps, as you can see on the ticker at the bottom of your screen. So got to do it all again then. Jesse James Shedden from pole after that first great start. Complete reset and, yeah, take two.
Yeah, can't wait for that then. So 10 laps just as we were previously. With the riders, I've got to say, Fran, they're not looking too nervous, frankly. I mean, Jesse James Shedden just came straight in and just sat on his bike in the garage. There we go. Blake Wilson there, I think that is. Just sort of waiting around. Oh, no, that's not actually Blake it's Wilson. That's Joshua Williams, 49. Yep. I thought it said 48. So there we go. There is Jesse James. A couple of scuffs on his as well then.
Guys, just a very, very quick update. Just popped into the back of the American team garage just to have a quick check on number 34, Kensai Matsudaira. Happy to report he is back in the paddock. He's got a few scrapes and a few bumps on his left leg. There's some quite hefty ice packs going on there right now, but happy to report he looks relatively okay after that earlier crash.
All right, thank you very much, Bertie, for that one then. Good news. So no more racing for him then for today. Kensai, unfortunately, not making it back out, but the other riders about to make it back out as well then. As we get ready for the restarted race one.
So everyone getting ready then, you can hear the rumble of the engines. And yeah, definitely not looking for any more repeat wheelies.
Not from pit lane, anyways.
Certainly not from pit lane.
They have got a proper little pit exit, which takes you actually round to turn three.
They also had a calm down yesterday, so they have done so in pit lane a little bit.
All right.
They were very eager yesterday, absolutely pinning it.
Yeah, no pit lane limiters on these bikes, are there?
So you know, once you are let out on track two head round, just keep it still nice and sensible, please, was the advice. So here we go then. Sighting lap again, back round to the grid, and like we said, original grid position, so it's a full take two.
Yeah, full take two. Round they come then, the turn four in the actual full Grand Prix circuit, but let's say there's actually two corners there, and the turn four is actually the right-hander. It's the world famous one because in the colder conditions it is very, very treacherous indeed. But actually that corner there is now turn five on this particular track. But other than that, it does look very, very similar on the layout to the proper Grand Prix circuit.
It actually took me an embarrassing minute to realise that. I walked around the track on Tuesday.
Oh, yeah?
And I was like, oh.
Well, quite a few riders actually didn't notice it yesterday, to be fair, as well. So the ones who haven't actually trained, I guess they didn't quite register that.
Yeah. So, but yeah, it is, like we said, an almost replica with those two S's added in. And then we got a nice hello from Aaron Canet there as well. Some good GIF material, if anyone's looking for it.
So then I guess it's pretty much all eyes on the front row again then, because Jesse James Shedden was so strong in that first stopped race. Then Blake Wilson alongside him, very, very strong as well. You also had, of course, the number 14 of Rostagny, the Frenchman who crashed in qualifying race one, looking pretty good as well. This is a quick restart procedure, so this will be, yes, quick turn off and then they'll be doing a warm-up lap and back around again they come, I'm assuming.
They will indeed, yep.
So, oh, we did have a... Oh, no. Do you know, I thought I had a little scraping in my earphones, but I couldn't tell what it was. I thought maybe Bertie's microphone had come on or something, but no, that is... who's
That's
gone down?
Luca
That's Freer.
Freer.
Yeah, Luca
yeah.
Freer's gone down. So he crashed in the first race too.
Yeah, he was either adjacent to or part of that incident that actually brought out the red flag. And sadly then, the Frenchman will not be making it around to take his place on the grid.
Disaster.
That's a bit of a disappointment for him.
Yeah, big
but,
time.
But if intentions were to be clearer from Jesse James Shedden, I'm not sure how. Absolutely shot off on the warm-up lap then.
Yeah, he's absolutely up for it, isn't he? So this could be a really good qualifying race too. And after that, it's only championship point scoring races left. Two more. So two down, three to go here at the FIM Mini GP World Series final.
We are indeed. So yeah, so this one again, no points. Winner moves through. So there's a lot on the line, but there are no more points on the line at the moment. So it's just a place in the next race. So we'll have to see who's going to take it. I think favourite's got to be Jesse James Shedden after what we saw in the first start.
But you never know how a rider's going to react after a little forced stop. Maybe the others are just able to find a little bit of extra speed. We were taking a look at Emil Idzhar there, the Malaysian rider, number 28, who's coming through. Not quite sure with all the changes where he'll be lining up on the grid, but we'll keep an eye out nonetheless.
Shuffled forward a little bit,
yeah,
I believe.
Yeah, a little bit. Well, green flag waves at the back of the grid. Lights are about to come on and we restart this qualifying two race if in the FIM Mini GP World Series. And it's a big jump from plenty of the riders then, though. And look, it's Blake who's got out front ahead of Jesse James Shenton. He couldn't quite replicate his warm-up lap start, but will he overtake him into turn two? He has
done.
Class move.
Yeah, that was nice stuff then. Great start from Blake Wilson to get ahead, especially under more pressure of knowing that Jesse James Shenton had made that amazing start to the first race. But the American has struck back, and once again he's leading this qualifying race too.
Yeah, that was really a really impressive sort of first move dive by Wilson in towards turns 1, 2 and 3, but equally very impressive from Shen to take it back. You got number 14 of Matias Rostanyi there into third place, chasing down Blake Wilson. You can see the size difference between some of these young riders. Jesse James Shenton really grown, I hear from John Hopkins actually yesterday whilst he was down in pit lane. He's really grown over this year actually, really starting to shoot up, whereas Blake Wilson bit younger, not quite there yet, but I suppose that might give him a little bit of a speed advantage down the straight, just slightly though.
Down this is just tuck in.
Yeah.
But no, yeah, for sure. It's an interesting one as well with the 10 to 14 age range. That can play a bit of a part, for sure. But at the moment, then it's a little bit closer than we had at this stage in the first running of this race on that first start. But Jesse James Shenton once again leads from Blake Wilson, but that gap not quite what it had been. No. Be interesting over race distance as well, because Shenton had absolutely nailed the first bit of the first start, but we didn't get to see that many laps.
Ooh, so that was a big moment. That was a big moment for Rostanyi in the background there. Has he lost a playstyle? Not quite sure. He does struggle through that part. And look at this. The guy's absolutely loving watching this part. He has lost a place. Who's gone ahead of him? One of the Malaysian riders. I couldn't quite see which number it was exactly, though.
Yeah, no, and it's impossible to tell with anything else, really, with all the suits and the helmets. So it's not that we've not done our research. It's that, unfortunately, visually, there aren't too many cues. So we'll have a look then coming through here.
It's the number 27. Yeah, there we are.
So good stuff then from the Malaysia Series rider. Managing to get past there after that bobble again for Rostanyi. He was probably a little bit more nervous around there after, like we said, he had that incident in qualifying race one.
Well then, Shenton, fastest lap of the race so far, 47.4. How does that compare to what we saw in free practice? That would have put him well inside the top eight, actually. So the pace is just getting better and better for these young riders.
Yeah, no, for sure. Obviously, they've had more and more time on the track. And, that's a bit of a dramatic zoom. More and more time on the track, and that's really starting to show in some of these guys. So if nothing else, they've learnt a lot, obviously, throughout the event as well, and about their level and where they slot in, where they maybe will be able to improve. But at the moment, then, the winner takes all will be Jesse James Shenton, but he has got some company from the UK and Malaysia Series riders just behind him.
Yeah, Pooja coming on really, really strong, actually. And I've got to say, walking up and down pit lane, chatting to a couple of people yesterday, as we see Pekabang Nair come to join the fun here today. A couple of riders and sort of team coaches pointing out that the problem is some of the riders are a little bit taller than others. They are at a bit of a disadvantage. However, you've got two of the taller riders out there in P1 and P3 in this race.
Yeah, it's an interesting one. Like we said, with the ages, you can obviously start to grow earlier, later. It can have such an effect. But yeah, at the moment, it's really not penalising too much, is it, for those two guys? So good stuff from them. And then Blake Wilson, pocket rocket in second. Good job from him as well. He's only very small. It's impressive stuff. And also under the pressure of this race.
Yeah, exactly. Absolutely same for all of them. And look at that then. So fastest lap of the race from Pooja, 47.2 lap time that last time around. That would have put him well inside the top five in the free practice standings, in fact, then.
Yep, indeed. So yeah, the pace is definitely hotting up in this one. But at the moment, Jesse James Shenton just keeping it nice and clean in the lead there. But he's not been able to shake them off. So it's going to be interesting. Where could a move come? Are they going to be able to stay with him throughout this race? Is he going to be able to keep it clean? We've got a few more laps to go to find out.
Yeah, interesting difference in line choices there. I think Blake Wilson running slightly more sweeping lines, so maybe a little bit more corner speed rather than just direct sort of point and shoot like Jesse James Shenton's been sort of running through those final chicanes. That's where you can really see sort of the main difference between riding styles, I suppose, around this track. But they're not letting him get away, are they? It's a little bit like we saw with the Spaniards in race one.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, it's interesting, isn't it? Because we... In the first start, we saw a bit of a bigger gap, but this time around, they really have managed to stay with him and pull back a couple of metres as well. So great stuff from those guys. And we've still got five to go as well, so they've got plenty of time to just make sure they stay in that rhythm. There's a nice tight line there from Blake Wilson there, and really did make up a bit more time as well.
Yeah.
The number 48 home lane, is he going to go for it? Not this time round.
But he is looking almost impatient, like he thinks he can run a better pace than Shedden out front. I was looking at Shedden coming down into turn 14, round that long left-hander of turn 13, breaking it into turn 14. The front end really bubbles. He's not afraid of that bike moving underneath him, is he?
Yeah, no, a few of them seem okay to just kind of rodeo it out a bit, don't they? And it doesn't seem to faze them. But I don't know. It's getting close out there, isn't it? And Poutra as well looking impatient by this point.
Yeah, so perhaps maybe Shedden's slowing them up a little bit, potentially. Will they be able to find an overtaking spot to make a move on him? Will it be round here? We're in turn 13, turn 14. But do you know what? No, because Shedden is actually very strong on the brakes there. He actually seems to gain a little bit. But Blake Wilson looks very hot on his tail, potentially making a move into turn one. He does look once again.
Yeah, I think he's obviously eyeing that up, made that work off the starting line as well. So I think that seems to be where Blake thinks is the best place to attack. Because like you said, Shedden pretty strong in some parts of the track. But Poutra now then, the man with a little bit less space ahead of him, looking like he's going to really strike soon. But
he does try to make a move, but unfortunately gets the front of his bike nose cut off there by Wilson. So he's great at defending as well as the young Brit.
Great classic commentary moment there, where my reaction was to hold my breath and not say anything. But so it's getting a little bit feisty then between the top three, and they've still got a little bit of time left to shuffle it out if anyone can make that move stick.
But I tell you what, with that move, it looks like Shedden's managed to get just a couple of bike lengths further out front. So Blake Wilson ain't going to be able to get him into there. He's managed to, probably a better line for him through turns one, two, and three that time around. But Poutra looks very strong there as well. I wonder if at this point, if a little bit of fatigue may be coming into it. I mean, that extra pressure, extra adrenaline going to be sapping your energy a little bit more, perhaps.
Yeah, and by this point in life, you're not a fully... have a little look up the inside.
Nearly
a real moment
high side
there
as well, yeah.
Real slide on the rear there, but Poutra keeps it on track then. But yeah, these guys then obviously giving it everything in this qualifying race too. And I don't know. That could be the decider. I'm not sure.
We're going to get a replay of that little moment. Just a little bubble, and then as he applies the throttle, comes right round. Not quite speedway style. We're not yet at that speed on these Avalle machines, but penultimate lap, no. Oh, this is the final lap now, so I hope they got the checkered flag ready this time around.
Absolutely. So I think that is quite a good gap for Jesse James Shedden. If he doesn't make a mistake with a few little shuffles behind him, that could help the American stay ahead in this race. And it is the winner heading through. So can he keep it nice and tidy? He'll be pushing on, and Blake Wilson will be looking for an open door to try and take over at the front. But I think at the moment, the American looks pretty comfortable.
Yeah, he does look pretty comfortable. Very good at defending. Didn't really leave any room for young Blake Wilson to try and make a move on him, and this looks pretty clean as well. So out sort of the near penultimate corners they come, at one chicane to go, keep it very planted, out he comes, and Shedden will be going through into race two and therefore the super final. Well, indeed. That was pretty awesome. So, but we have a Malaysian technically on the podium of that race though. Let's pass back down to pit lane though, because Matt Burt has Hafiz Shah in with him. Yeah, we can now.
Just making sure that we've got no tech problems. Hafiz, I'm not too sure watching that race whether you were more nervous than Faris out there. What was it like watching that one?
Yeah, it's like a throwback my story, you know. But I was with the pocket bike. Now they are a bit upgraded, and we are always improve every year to improve the bike. And happy to see the kids that enjoy in this race. Also, thank you to MotoGP and Ovalle and FIM Mini GP to make it this happen. And I hope this championship growing more bigger in the Asia, especially because mostly it's difficult from the other side, also in Europe, to make more countries rider.
Well, it looked like you enjoyed that race. We'll start the podium celebrations very shortly. I hope you're a little bit more relaxed for your own race here on a Sunday. Thanks for joining us, Hafiz. Thank you.
Oh, thank you very much, Hafiz Sharin and Matt Burt. There is Sheldon comes back in. Big thumbs up. He will be going through to race two starting. Well, I guess there will be no change in schedule, so it will just be a slightly shorter gap before the next one, I suppose, Fran. What is the time now? Acceleration line about 12:34, so yeah, we're about 50 minutes behind schedule. So we'll be having a shorter gap, I suppose.
I think we will indeed. So, yeah, that was a good race, though.
Yeah.
Some tension in there in the final few laps. And, yeah, Blake Wilson obviously gave it everything, not quite enough there. And Putra too, the Malaysian rider, really made a step forward, I think, from the first start as well, which is great to see. So good stuff from those guys. But it's Jesse James Shedden moving through.
Yeah, so, well, two Americans in both qualifying races have managed to move through into the key races then. So
and
good
interestingly,
for them.
Not the champion from the...
No, exactly, though. I mean, so you got Kenzai Matsudaira. How old is he compared to the others? He's 11 years old, isn't he? And I think Jesse James Shedden, he's 12 years old, so a little bit older. And then Jaden Fernandez still. So these are the final results. Jesse James heading through into race two. Blake Wilson was second place from Faris Pucha. That was a great ride from him. Hafi was in fourth from Itar. It's a great ride from the Malaysians in that race, I reckon.
Yeah, locked out that third to fifth, didn't they? And then we've got Rostanye, Levi Flier, Joshua Williams and Enzo Giacomino. Finn and Verity, and Lorenzo Vicente then from the Portuguese series at the back. And then we had those crashes, unfortunately, not in that race in the end after that incident in the first start.
Yep, so winner of qualifying race two goes straight to the championship points scoring race two. You'll have to join us in a mo.
Soltero, hoy. Hoy es un día de...
Welcome back then. So, race two with championship points about to get going. 10 laps it will be. And then after this, we have one more race, the super final of 12 laps. Double points available in that one. So really is kicking on with the championship aspect of the FIM Mini GP World Series final here then. Quite toasty, frankly, Fran, isn't it?
I know,
out
I was
there
just
in
thinking.
The ambient temperature.
It's actually very pleasant today. It's a little bit warmer than it was in Portimao for sure. And there's a bit of a cold breeze coming up off the coast. But here we are, of course, by the sea, but a little bit further away. And yeah, lovely weather for these guys. And Enea Bastianini, you can see the Italy Series ambassador, still down there as the riders head out to line up for another race with points in play.
Yeah, 25 points, 20, 16, 13, 11, 10, 9, 8. That's how, sorry, yeah. Is how it goes. Yep. So, yes, that is the standard point scoring method for a world championship.
Amazingly enough, we've been working
racing
here for a long time.
Yeah, it's one of those things you can't forget, isn't it?
I use 8 for 8th as like the midpoint marker to check that I've not gone wrong,
yeah,
between like 4th and 8th.
I remember that then, 8 for 8th. Yeah, that's the only one which lines up, isn't it? So.
Exactly.
If I may, apologies again, but I'm down here with the Italian ambassador, Enea Bastianini, who's just been having a little chat with the three Italians that are about to go in this race. Enea, it looks like you're enjoying soaking up the atmosphere and giving some words of encouragement to your riders.
Yeah, I'm very happy to be here to watch this young rider, and it's a very beautiful day. And now we will see what this rider what can do. And I try all my best to recover some position from to win this race with one of these three.
You ride the modern-day MotoGP bikes, which are the coolest and fastest bikes in the world, but what do you make of these little Ovali machines? They look quite cool and fun to ride and good experience for the young riders.
Yeah, this is a very good experience. When I was young, there isn't this, and can be a very good opportunity for the future of all these riders and to arrive in the really world championship like Moto3.
And I enjoy this race. I'm sure it's going to be a cracker, and have some fun.
Awesome stuff. Thank you very much, Bertie and Enea Bastianini. Bastianini will be cheering on Eduardo Liguori, who played a big part in race one. Also, Gabriel Buono, who we talked about as well. Christian Borelli, we didn't mention so much earlier on, though, fam.
We didn't know, but yeah, very much on the grid and looking for some glory in this one, and some points, of course, before double points in the super final race. So there's still plenty on the line. Starting off with a race win or a second place, as this rider got earlier, is very well and good, but it's all going to come down to that final race, we imagine.
Yeah, they were looking at Pablo Olivares, who got second place in the race earlier on, of course, won by Ethan Rodriguez. We had the third Spaniard, Alberto Enriquez, actually in the battle all the way for third position, fighting for second, but unfortunately he crashed out towards the end of that first race.
He did indeed. So yeah, he'll definitely be looking for some revenge and to get some points on the board, having lost that chance earlier on. So speak of the devil and he shall appear. Alberto Enriquez then looking for a little bit more from this one, but good to see rider perfectly okay and able to obviously line up again to do a little bit more battle. So really good stuff, and those brollies all looking good, and they actually are necessary, aren't they, now, like we said, with the sun.
Toasty.
It's quite,
and those
quite
dark
tasty
leathers, yeah, will absorb the heat and everything. Here's Joshua Breen, who got a cracking podium in that first race. 16 points to him after that first one, perhaps a little bit unexpectedly. The thing we've got to make sure of is they don't do an extra lap in this one.
Yep, definitely. A bit of a delay on the checkered flag, first time out in the points-paying races, but hopefully this time around then we will get the 10 intended laps and not a single one more. And also, hopefully in this one we'll see everybody able to finish and some good battles, because it'd be a bit of a heartbreaker if we have another crasher here. So Eduardo Liguori, though, he just lost out with that flag having been out at just about the wrong time, because he was really fighting hard for that third place in the final step on the podium with O'Brien. So let's see what he's got this time around. And Pekka then still on site down there,
loving it, isn't he? Well, they all are. Selfie time for him as well. You got the number 11 of Matteo Massilli alongside Liguori. He is of the Alpe Adria Moto GP Mini GP team, I should say, not the Murder GP team. Not just yet.
Be quite a jump.
Sorry. Give it 10 years.
It's me again. Yeah. Sorry, I don't know if you can hear me. I'm just going to cut in very, very quickly. I'm delighted to say I've got Factory Ducati star Pecco Bagnaia alongside me just before the start of this race too. Pecco, what are your thoughts on your first view of this brilliant FIM Mini GP World Series?
I think that they organized really nice things. It was like when I was young, there was the European Championship, and it was like the same thing, and I was enjoying a lot. So for me, it's a really nice idea, and will be very good for the young talents.
And it looks like there are three very fast Italians as well that might be giving you a hard time in about 10 years' time.
Yeah, the Italians always are competitive in these categories, and I hope that they will have a nice future, because I think that they are very competitive.
Pecco, we appreciate you talking to us. Have a great weekend here in Valencia. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Pecco Bagnaia. Then let's get a look at this grid for race two. It's very similar to that of race one. Fran, do you take us through it?
It is. So we have, like we said, Rodriguez, Olivares and Enriquez on the front row. Lockout for the Mini GP Spain series. O'Brien, Liguori, Massili from Alpe Adria, Vuono, Borelli and Nyland then on the top three rows of the grid. And then we have Matos, Benacek, Reis, Baldi, Fernandez and Shedden now. So that back row, Baldi and Fernandez came through qualifying race one, and Shedden we just saw win qualifying race two.
There you are. Grid positions based on championship standings. Not too dissimilar to what the original grid in race one, but some small differences there then. So that's what it says at the bottom of the screen.
It does indeed. I'm not sure how Enriquez then got third place on the grid, if we do still have that Mini GP lockout at the front.
Well, anyway, we await the race start. So warm-up lap set in coming for the young riders, and we'll be getting going racing again. 10 laps to go, of course. 30-second, 1-minute board is out, I should say. Riders probably getting a little bit more nervous now, I would imagine, because now is the second biggest race of their lives, pretty much, coming up.
It is indeed. Yep, so getting ready to go then.
Props to Ana Rosa Spalletta as well, in charge of this mini-series, even picking up the umbrellas and picking up things off the grid, helping out.
Always get stuck in.
Hands-on all the time, and even consoling some of the young riders yesterday. A bit upset with not making it through to the seeded races.
As we said, the emotions run a little higher and and cooler.
Yeah.
You know, you can read them all like a little book. It's good experience, though, in terms going through an event as well and learning about that stuff and resetting for the next race and all of that. Those things, but very much everyone making sure there's hugs on hand if needed.
There's always hugs needed. It's racing.
Yeah, famously that is one of the central tenets of motorcycle racing.
Racing's life, anything before or after a hugs. That's how the phrase goes, isn't it? Anyway, we're looking at the mini back straight now. So this is coming in towards turn eight, and the Spaniards doing as they did in race one, just sort of hanging back on this warm-up lap then.
Yeah, it's a little bit. Who was it? Was it Casey Stoney used to do that, and Jorge Lorenzo used to blast off, wasn't it?
Well, there
and
is
Romano Fanati as well.
Is Ethan Rodriguez then your winner from race one at the mini number 44, obviously looking towards Pola Spargaro as a tip for the future.
It's quite cool that they ended up with those numbers and they've got Pol as their ambassador, because it isn't chosen.
Exactly. If you didn't join us early, we did cover that the numbers are allocated to them.
No sass if you didn't. We're just delighted you're here now.
Well then, lining up on the grid we come then. So pretty big race this one. It will go a long way to potentially deciding who will be the FIM Mini GP World Series champion in 2021. The red flag departs at the start of the grid. The lights will come on, they'll go off, and we'll be racing once again. We're racing once more, and the starts were a lot cleaner that time around. Front wheels plenty on the floor, and it is Ethan Rodriguez taken towards the front pole position once again. Smooth as you like.
Yeah, really smooth once again. The three Spanish guys then and the head of this race for the moment, and then that was too quick. I think it's Italian, not Irish, though, in fourth at the moment. It's hard to tell under this light.
No, it is O'Brien.
It's not. I've been wrong again. I'm very sorry to Ireland.
Liguori's just behind him
once again. So that fourth place battle that we had earlier, then it looks like it might be about to spark once again in race two. But a clean start, like you said, for all the Spanish riders, and once again number 44 ahead. Who is this?
Oh, Shedden has gone down. Oh, disaster!
No.
He's trying to get going again. Struggling as he has he got power? Yes, he is. He'll get going, but that's his race over, unfortunately. Big crash there in the background coming out of the final turn. That looks like one of the French riders who's gone down there. Nasty little high side for him. Hope we see him get up and walking away from that one pretty swiftly. But it is still the three Spanish riders out front. And Abrin has been overtaken by Liguri there. Oh, there he is. Already come over. That is the number 32. That is Nyland, the Dutch rider.
Yeah, it is. So again, those colours there. Oh, saw someone go really wide there. Not sure what happened there. Was it Enriquez? But yes, a big crash then for Ruben Nyland, the Dutch rider. Looks up and okay-ish, a bit winded, as you can imagine, if you've had a high side. So glad he's walked away from that one straight away. And it's as you were in the front two then, but it must have been quite a moment then for Enriquez in third, because he's lost a lot of time there. And O'Brien already starting to attack.
Is that Liguri? Yeah, trying to make a move on the inside. Wow, look at the corner speed that that he had O'Brien carrying there. Caught right back onto him. That was really impressive.
It really was, yeah. So this is a great little three-way battle now for that final step on the podium then. O'Brien already been on that once already today. So plenty at stake. But Enriquez, must have been quite a wobble. And now he's back into the clutches of what was the battle for third earlier on as well.
That was a slide and a half from Rodriguez.
It's all not completely pitch perfect at the front then, and I'm sure that Olivares will have seen that and be trying to home in and just unsettle him a little bit more.
Yeah, that was you would have seen that. That is a little chink in the armour, potentially so. It's a good little slide nonetheless. And who's this? That is Liguri going out the inside into P3 there. Oh, but what about? Oh, goodness me, O'Brien coming up the outside there. It's caused the right backup of riders there,
hasn't
it? Yeah,
it really did, didn't it? Everyone looking for a way through there, but in the end, just Liguori getting that done then. So he moves into third place, the Italian.
Enriquez.
So that's great stuff from him. But Enriquez still holding on to fourth then, but O'Brien looking for a way through for sure. Some different lines from the Irish rider, but it's working for him so far. Super tight around there, the number 22. So keeps fourth place, but I'm sure he'll be looking to try and regroup and attack.
Yeah, no doubt at all. But this battle at the front, well, it's a battle between the top two, isn't it? I mean, they've got this win pretty much sewn up, potentially. Well, one of them has, should everything stay
tempting,
fairly fine and dandy.
Tempting dramatic fate there.
Yeah, for six laps to go. Paulo Espargaró watches on as the riders all do a flyby. Pretty loud as well, these bikes. Well, sound like proper little race bikes in the garages.
Yeah, it's very good. It's a nice little choir, isn't it, when they all fire up and get going. So it's as you were then at the moment in this battle for third. But, so that must be shedding then at the back. Yep, so he has managed to keep going then in this race. We're getting a replay of what happened to him.
Oh, no, that's not Shedden's crash.
That's not Shedden's crash. That's the Nyland crash, we believe.
Yeah, guys, just a quick update actually on Ruben Nyland. He has just come back to the back of the pits here. He looks okay, a little bit beaten up, a little bit sorry for himself as well. I think at the moment it's more disappointment than pain. He'll be on his way to the medical centre for a quick checkup, but no major concerns.
Good, thanks a lot for that update, Bertie. So, good to see then he's all right and looking for a little bit of maybe emotional support after that checkup as well.
Yeah, that's fair enough. You saw Bo Bensnader, the Moto2 rider, down in the Team Netherlands pit. Also, Barry Venneman, World Supersport legend, obviously playing a big part in that team as well. He's been down and around, so plenty of support from the national... Well, national squad, you could say then, for those riders.
I enjoy that phrasing a lot. But as you can see then, Olivares really very much still with our race leader, Ethan Rodriguez. So really good stuff here. And he's looking like he's starting to think about really making a move rather than just shadowing at the moment as well. So I wouldn't be surprised if that comes pretty soon from the number 46 there, just tacked on in second place. But these guys, though, it's really an exhibition now, isn't it, from these top two. And at the moment then, Enriquez looks like he's still in fourth place as well, so pressure on a little bit to try and keep up with his compatriots, but we'll see what happens there. So we've got a little bit more of a gap there. We've got Liguori and then Enriquez, then we've got another Italian flag, I believe, behind there.
Yeah, it'll be either the 25 or 24, I think, because I didn't see a number 11 from him. So it'll be either Buono or Borelli fighting, so that means O'Brien's been shoved back just a little bit. I've got to say, whilst these two, definitely out front. They're pretty secure out there. It's not as if they're clearing off by 10 seconds or so, is it?
No, it's not too much to affect the other guys seeing the gap they've got. They've also had a really clean race so far, not any moves or shuffling, which obviously as well helps you pull away a little bit. That pack race, and they've had some moments where they've all shuffled and held each other up as well, where they've been trying to get through into that third position. So, great job from the 44 and the number 46, and great display. But I think that fight for the podium also can take a lot of heart from their pace.
Yeah, totally. Yeah, I completely agree. And also points mean prizes as well. If you know, it does mean something to finish, you know, top 10 in the FIA Mini GP World Series.
It means something to even be in this race.
Exactly.
In the first,
to even be at this event.
Exactly.
You know?
Yeah.
So I think when the dust has settled, all these riders can probably sit back and think, do you know what? It's pretty good.
Yeah, for sure. So, good stuff then. So it looks like we have got then an Italian bike through into fourth that starts with a number two, but again, didn't quite catch the number there. So we'll try and have a look next time around.
And we'll go to the opticians in winter as well.
We will as well, yeah, for sure. But these guys then, great duel at the front, but no way through at the moment for Olivares. So where is he going to try and make that move?
Much like the bigger cousin, the mini Grand Prix circuit is quite difficult to overtake, much like the proper
easiest.
Grand Prix circuit.
It's not the easiest.
But it looks like he was about to make a move there, actually. 46 lining up Ivan out front in for a move potentially in towards turn one. He is swarming all over the back of him, so I think a move has got to be incoming. But just look how quick Ivan Rodriguez is through turns one, two, and three, and the lines he runs, very, very different.
Yeah, very difficult to get past as well. But I'm sure you want to strike this time around. We are on to the last lap, according to our graphics. So, will a move come from the number 46? He got beaten earlier on, so surely he'll try and have a go.
Oh, he is trying to look up the inside there. That was much more of a sweeping line from Rodriguez. Definitely inviting a move, you could say. So just a few more corners to go. This is turn 12. Flick it left into turn 13. Will he line him up in towards turn 14 for a move? No, he's only got one more opportunity. Can he basically straight line the chicane? Not quite so much. Get a drive out. Neck and neck across the line they come, and it's who got the win? Don't know.
very close. We don't know who's third either, because that was incredibly close. Two Italians then. It was Liguori and Borelli in the end, who we hadn't talked about too much on the earlier race, but Christian Borelli then from the Mini GP Italy series. I think
Ethan Rodriguez got
Rodriguez held on to it. Okay, so confirmation then that Rodriguez has done the double so far. And then we had Olivares in second. I keep wanting to say Oliveira. Apologies if I do at some point. Reasons obvious. Great number 44 on top again. Then great ride from him. And great performance from the Mini GP Spain series, guys. A 1-2. And who's locked out the podium? Hopefully we will find out.
Yeah, we will see.
It's definitely an Italian this time around. Definitely an Italian.
Enriquez,
it's the number 24, we believe, who's locked out the podium. So it is Borelli then in the end gets that final place on the podium.
Cracking job. That's from near enough, around P8 on the grid-ish?
Yeah, good ride. And made some good progress compared to race one. So that's really nice stuff to see. Also good to see different faces on the podium, although not on the top and second steps just yet. That may come in the super final race. You never know. So some good points then. That's going to be an interesting shuffle in the standings.
Yeah, absolutely. In they come in towards Parc Fermé then. The makeshift Parc Fermé. Applause all around. So then for the second time, you have a 44 in first and the 46 in second. Will it be three from three? Because we do have one more race to go, of course. The super final coming up at around about 2:00.
I thought you were going to say, will it be the same on Sunday?
Might be a little bit earlier, actually, won't it? Yeah, same on Sunday. There we are. This is nice to see. Those two close friends as well, clearly. Oh, nice hug as well. Forget just a handshake. Give me a hug. That was lovely.
That's nice, yeah.
Because there's a thing actually at this stage when it's very, very competitive and they all fiercely want to win, of course. But especially the young riders from all the different countries, they're travelling together. They're all pretty much mates.
Yeah, exactly. That's what Farmi and Norlina from Sepang Circuit as well said about the Malaysians. They're all from Selangor. They've all come three pocket bikes together. They're more like three brothers now, with real rivalry, but also, you know, from the best place. Just pure competition. So yeah, it's nice to see that in the Mini GP World Series, and good celebration as well. You like to see that. And now we'll get to see the podium again.
So Morelli taking third position then. He'll be very chuffed with that. Helmets off, and we head towards the podium. Podium caps, of course. These are, well, the only sort of road to MotoGP program that will have Pirelli.
It is indeed, yes. Joining our friends in the Motul FIM Superbike World Championship. Almost said it the wrong way around due to MotoE having the sponsor on the other side of the FIM. But, yep, so great stuff to see. So much support from the partners, of which, yeah, Pirelli obviously is a key one. All Pirelli tyres.
Well then, here is Pablo Olivares.
Yeah, looks happy enough. Looks happy enough. I'm sure he'll be very much gunning to get some revenge in the superfinal race. If he does, of course, they'd be equal on points.
Ooh,
with double.
And then,
if
But then, because I suppose Ethan Rodriguez won the first race, he would take the championship because he's got more wins.
I don't know. Would it be? Does a double points race count as a single win when you're doing that?
Maybe.
It's going to be a high pressure mathematics situation later, potentially.
Christian Borelli. Always got a cheer for riders wearing spectacles. As a spectacle wearer myself, it's very difficult to wear a helmet with spectacles.
As a contact lens wearer, I empathise.
Exactly.
That's what pushed me over the edge.
Here are then those final results from race two. Ethan Rodriguez, P1 from Pablo Olivares, P2. Christian Borelli takes third ahead of countryman Eduardo Liguori. Then Alberto Enriquez was fifth, and Joshua Brien pushed back to sixth there towards the end. Gabriel Buono there in seventh place from Massilia, who kept it upright this time. And Matos, the Portuguese rider, who started from near enough about 10th on the grid, made it up towards 9th. Benetech, the Czech rider, was 10th from Baldi, Fernandez, Race and Shedden bringing out the last of the finishers, and Nyland. A big crash, but fortunately okay, being checked up in the medical centre after that one.
Yeah, so Portuguese making some good progress today. Pedro Matos done that in both races so far, so that'll give him a little bit of confidence as well going into the super final race. So I think we can hear Bertie beginning the ceremony.
Well, Borelli comes out onto the podium then.
Put your hands together, please, for second place, Pablo Olivares from MiniGP Spain.
And, of course, your winner for the second time here today.
Race winner now. Congratulations to race winner Ethan Rodriguez, also from MiniGP Spain.
Things are going well for MiniGP Spain, that's for sure, isn't it?
I'm delighted to welcome Ovalink sales representative.
So, more dignitaries onto the podium as well. Sales representative from Ovalink, America Barbiero.
Marika Barbiero will also present the second place prize.
And as you can hear from Bertie, we'll also be presenting the second place prize. Then delivering the first place one, the owner of iPower.
The race two winning trophy is iPower owner Christian Priami.
Christian Priami, as you would have heard there from our dear colleague Matthew Burt.
And we will now hear the national anthem of Spain.
Well then, special moment there for Ethan Rodriguez getting his national anthem for the second time on a single day in front of other home fans here in Valencia.
Yeah, not a bad day's work so far. And very much the points leader as we head into the super final race.
Well, yeah, these are the championship standings, of course. And so 50 points from 50 for Ethan Rodriguez. Pablo Olivares, 40 points. Josh O'Brien, still third place, minus 24 points. And then Liguori in fourth from Borelli. Massive points haul with that third place there. Buono, Matos, Ortega, and Benatek, the in ninth position. 13 points to his name. Then Massili, Baldi, Rice, Nyland, Fernandez and Shedden. 8 points for Fernandez. Shedden gets 2 points coming home in 14th place. And of course, still up for grabs fully. I mean, technically, everybody's still in for a shout at the victory of the overall series.
Yep, they very much are, because like we said, there are double points in the super final race. I think we're going to get some highlights of race two now.
Yeah, very very jazzy music, keeping you upbeat, ready for that super final coming your
up.
Way.
It threw me off.
We're going to a party now or what? Super final coming up relatively shortly. I'm pretty sure we're still following the same order. It's around about 35 minutes time. It starts at 2 p.m. Build-up starts at 1:50, just under half an hour. So you'll have to join us then. It's been a great day's racing so far, and the FIM Mini GP World Series comes to a head in just about half an hour's time. Join us for that.
Since many years ago, we started the Road to MotoGP. We started in FIM CEP, then we do the different talent caps. But we realized that was a gap in the lower age.
And for many years, we have been trying to come up with a format that would be suitable at all levels in all countries.
So for the kids between 10 and 14 years old, we have put on the move this year the Mini GP FIM World Series.
With the collaboration of Ovale, which made a bike that was great for this type of ages, we developed these series, which makes it affordable and easy for federations around the globe to have their own national, regional, or continental championships, which will then lead into a final, which would give us the champion every year.
This is the first step. Then you have the FIMSEV, you have the Red Bull Rookies Cup, we have all the Talents Cup in all over the world, and then we start the stairs from Moto3, Moto2, MotoGP. This is the aim. Some years of experience, of fighting, of some sacrifices, but also some glory. And this is what we want, starting with the 10 years old in Mini GP.
We have national, continental, or regional series. These are all at the same level, so there can be an FIM Mini GP North America series, which is a continental series, but there's also the FIM Mini GP Italy series, which is a national series. But they are all at the same level, and they all have access to the final, which will take place every year in the last round of the MotoGP championship. This year, for example, we have 10 cups around the globe, 10 series around the globe that will take part in the final. Out of these 10 cups, the top three of each cup will have access to this final, in which there will be free practice, qualifying, and five races with a super final race. And here, the champion of the FIM Mini GP World Series will be awarded.
The winner of this competition will be subsidized by us, by the championship, to grow in another specialty to try to continue his career. And maybe we can have, not just for the winner, to try to understand exactly where are the others and try to help them also.
We will have ambassadors selected from either MotoGP, Moto2, or Moto3, the one that is most adequate to the nationality of the riders that will be present at the final with the riders, and they will be helping them race during those days. So basically it's kind of a position as a mentor, as a coach also.
To have a role model, a hero, to be there to see, look, you can be like me.
And as many MotoGP riders already train with these Ovale bikes, they know how to use them. So it will be a great help for the MiniGP riders to get feedback from the MotoGP riders.
I think we have started in the right foot. We are doing well, the kids love it, and we are having wonderful competition.
It's going very well, it's going very well. I have the information from the National Federation that is a lot of interest to see how good they are.
Everybody is very, very positive. 2022, we have already confirmed 14 countries, but I would like to have at least in the near future between 25, 30 countries going, so that we have one champion in Valencia from each country. This is the aim, this is our objective.
The Cups in 2022 will be basically the same as for 2021, just we'll need to have a minimum of 5 events and 10 races. Those that have their championships already established this year will continue next year, and we are hoping to get more.
Our idea is to make this this championship stable and to do it next year and the years after, and also every year with the experience of the year before, to try to improve the quality of the championship.
So it's for the first time MiniGP FIM World Cup in Czech Republic. It is an Alpe Adria series, so the Central European series. We are very proud to host this event, and we are glad that we can join it to the MiniGP Czech Championship. Thank you very much everybody for coming, and we hope to have some champions for next year.
Thank you to all the riders for being here at Cartagena Cab with the spectacular race. Next time we will meet at Vransko, Slovenia for the third round of FIM Mini GP Alpe Adria Series. Bye!
Ciao a tutti, mi chiamo Samuele Baldi e finalmente sono riuscito a vincere una gara dell'Alpe Adria Series con la mia ovale 160 e le impressioni sulla pista mi è piaciuta tanto la pista. E abbiamo vinto gara 1 e gara 2 battagliando con Matteo Masili che faccio i complimenti e in gara 2 è stato molto bravo a sorpassarmi dopo un mio errore e purtroppo all'ultimo giro è caduto e sono riuscito a vincere anche in gara 2 e poi la pista mi è piaciuta molto quindi ho cercato sempre di migliorare sempre di più passo passo e ringrazio la mia famiglia, i miei sponsor e mio padre che mi ha sostenuto tutto quanto il weekend e mi ha risolto tutti gli errori. Ciao a tutti.
Matsudera winning the 160 this weekend. I heard your friends come over. They congratulated you. What are these moments like?
I mean, it was my first time actually winning. But this year, with all the training in Europe, it's an unspeakable feeling. This was way more than I expected it to be.
Thank you.
campionato che va a Cristian Borrelli. Inno nazionale.
It was a very close race. Nathan and Jaden were right behind me. That just kept my pace up. The 160 class, it was a really close battle. I knew I still needed to push, otherwise they would catch me. It was a great race, very close.
The first FIM Mini GP World Series final will take place during Valencia GP Race Week, and here's everything you need to know about it. Vale GP0160s are the two-wheeled machines that will guide the next generation of young talent onto the world stage. The top few riders from each of the 10 FIM Mini GP series from around the world will converge on Valencia. At the heart of the world final format is the group lottery, consisting of three groups, A, B and C. Each group will have four free practices, with the aim being to set as fast a time as possible. Based on those times, the bottom 12 will head to Q1, the middle 10 will head to Q2, and the top 8 riders will qualify directly for Q3. The 12 riders in qualifying 1 will battle for 4 spots that will see them advance through to Q2. The same principle is then applied to Q2, as this time 14 riders will battle it out for the top 4 spots. After all that, we end up with 12 riders vying for pole position in qualifying 3, which will set the rest of the grid for Thursday's races. In qualifying race 1, the bottom 18 from qualifying practice will prepare to do battle. No championship points are up for grabs here, but the top two finishers will secure themselves a place in race one, along with a fastest 12 from qualifying practice, where championship points are indeed up for grabs. Qualifying race two is much the same as qualifying race one, but this time 16 riders will battle it out for just one spot that will see them transfer into race two. The top 15 of the championship after race two will race in the super final, where double points will be on offer. The rider with the most points after that will be crowned the winner and become the first FAM Mini GP World Series champion.
Yeah, we're ready to go. Cool, guy. There you go. Hello there and welcome back. This is it, the FIM Mini GP World Series final, super final race. These are the best of the best on the road to MotoGP program. This very first step, will we see, well, frankly, any of the 29 competitors we've had in this grand final World Series weekend? Will we see any of them in MotoGP in the future? Well, that remains to be seen. But what matters right now is what? 15 laps that we have of this super final. Who will win it and who will be the champion in 2021? My name is Matt Dunn. Alongside me, that you have experienced throughout the entire morning and day, is Fran Wild. And then we have Matt Burt down in pit lane. Fran, I'm sure that plenty of people will be watching throughout the day so far, but some people just starting to tune in for this one. How excited are you for this super final?
I'm very excited. I'm also delighted with the way that you did repeat the word final, as I'd wanted in the intro.
You're welcome.
But yeah, and it is super because it's double points on offer in this one. So you've had two races worth points already this morning. But now it is time to really sort out who is going home with the crown this year. Double points, so potentially we could end up tied on points as we had the same winner in race one and race two, but I don't know, I can't see he'll really come a cropper in this one after such domination so far, but there's been some great racing and we're ready for some more.
You never know, I reckon. You never know. We just saw that was a nice little moment. Jaden Fernandez and Jesse James Sheridan just having a little fist bump before the two remaining American riders who are competing in this super final head out on their sighting lap towards the grid. Sheridan finishing in 14th position in that race one as he came through after winning the second qualifying race. If you have only just joined us today, the action has gone like this. Qualifying race one, the top two have been allowed to then race in the official championship standings race one, race two, and this super final. After the first championship race, we had qualifying two with a top rider from that. Jesse James Sheridan is now eligible to compete in race two and the super final. But tell you what, Matt Burt, what have you got for us?
Yeah, hi, Matt. Thanks very much for joining. I'm delighted to say I'm here with Dorna CEO Carmelo Ezpeleta. Carmelo, a pleasure to see you down here for this super final. We know how much you've personally supported the successful MotoGP, Road to MotoGP program. But everybody I've spoken to here today says what a fantastic setup this FIM Mini GP World Series is. This must make you so proud.
Well, we are proud, of course. All together, we have started working almost 1 year ago to think that, and then now it's a very good result until now. And I think this is the first step. In the future, we will improve because with the experience we have of this year and the possibilities to improve things, I think then in the near future will be something much better even than today.
It's been a fantastic event so far in 2021, Carmelo. We look forward to the future. Enjoy the super final.
Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Bertie and Carmelo Ezpeleta, for that. We are seeing the riders line up on the grid then. We are looking at your pole position rider, Ethan Rodriguez, lining up alongside him, alongside the double race winner. Is the double two-time second place finisher so far today in the championship points runnings of race one and two, Pablo Olivares. Fran, it really has been about all those two so far, but we've had a mix of third place podium finishes in race one and two, Josh O'Brien, and then also Christian Borelli in that race we just had there. I don't think we could really call the full podium this time around.
No, it's been an interesting one. There's, like we said, we've had that switch for third place in each of the two races so far. Not a switch in the top two, though. It has been a mini GP Spain series lockout with Ethan Rodriguez and Pablo Olivares. But yeah, it was Josh O'Brien in the first race, and then in the second one, it was Christian Borelli. So we're switching Ireland for Italy then. But there's quite a competitive little group, it seems, behind those couple of Spanish guys who've so far just been the cream of the crop. But yeah, it'll be an interesting one. And you can see we've got some plenty of VIPs still there down there. That was FIM president George Viegas on the grid once again. So yeah, great stuff, and I'm sure the energy is really really rising now for the super final. And here is one of our podium finishers.
Yeah, Josh O'Brien had a great run out, really good job in qualifying to qualify fourth on the grid for these main races, and then of course that third position in race one. Their unofficial Ireland ambassador Cormac Ryan Meaney and the photographer will be very, very happy with that one.
But the real Ireland ambassador, of course, we should mention Brad O'Binder, the Red Bull KTM Factory Racing rider.
Is that Brad O'Binder or Brad O'Binder?
Brad O'Binder. We must give our colleague Lewis Sudderby props for that one, I have to say.
Yeah.
It wasn't a Fran Wild original.
Classic, but,
Lewis. Eduardo Liguori as well. He's had some great pace today. That's a good shot, isn't it? You can see super focused on the race that's coming up. But yeah, he's had some good speed, like I said, and he could be one of those fighting it out for the podium in this one again.
Yeah, I mean, we saw some plenty of moves, and it seems as though these riders have been getting faster and faster with every race as well. The laps are sort of running low 146s, very similar to what they were able to put out in qualifying, in fact. There is your previous podium finisher, Christian Borelli. Bertie, what have you got for us?
Yeah, guys, I'm down here on the grid with somebody who really knows how to spot young talent. He's got an eye for a future star. It's Repsol Honda manager Alberto Pugh, just come down to watch this super final. Alberto, what have you made of it so far?
Sorry?
What have you made of it so far, and what do you think about this this new series?
Well, it's very interesting. Frankly speaking, I didn't saw the bike before, but they're really, really nice. And I think this formula with kids so young, it's super important. It's like, it's not exactly like we had many years ago in Spain with the mini pocket bikes, because the bike is bigger, but it's more or less on that area, which I think is really, really interesting. And I think, yeah, this formula is going to be super effective, I'm sure.
Always great to hear from you, Alberto. We're just being cleared off the grid here now, so maybe out here there is the next Marc Marquez or next Casey Stoner. Back to you guys.
Yeah, thank you very much, Bertie and Alberto Puget. We also saw Alex Rins has made his way down towards the grid for this mini GP super final. Duran Mir will be here as well.
You sound like he just rolled out of pit lane, decided to give it a crack.
Yeah, he took a wrong turning on his Suzuki GSX RR. Much like it looks like the BMW safety car has taken a wrong turn and ended up here. Let's get a look at the grid then for this super final race as the full size safety car takes off on the mini GP track. We have then Ethan Rodriguez taking off from pole position ahead of Pablo Olivares, and then we have Josh O'Brien in third. Liguori, Borelli and Vuono, an Italian row
Italian
three.
Second
How many
row?
There's three riders who are Italian on row two. yes, it's near enough an all-American lockout on row five as well there, and two more Italians on row four ahead of them with Nyland. Good to see him back out there after that crash in the last race. And also Rice, the Portuguese rider, there in 12th position.
There we go.
Another Ethan.
I was going to say, yes, I do love that name.
Yeah, it's very nice.
It's a very nice name. So, yeah, Ethan Guevara, as well as Sergio Garcia, then down there from the GasGas Aspar squad.
Great to see not just MotoGP riders and Moto3 riders, Moto2, but also golfing legends coming down to watch the action here at MiniGP. Really sensational stuff. there's both Ben Slater watching on as well. He'll be glad that Ruben Nyland made it back out. Tyre warmers off, Fran. It's race time.
Tyre warmers off, and it is race time indeed. So now we do have the grid based on those championship standings for sure, with Josh O'Brien on that front row. So and Pedro Matos with those two rides through the field earlier, the Portuguese rider, he's really made some hay with that. Now he gets to start a little bit further forward, has a little bit less work to do. So I think this could be an interesting one, but we do have a familiar number 44 on pole position, and surely is the favourite for this one, although Olivares gave him a run for it in race two. Let's see what we're going to get this time round.
Well then, warm-up lap time were to be, and you can see through the back of the shot that we had there, you can see, well, we had Alberto Enriquez, who initially qualified on third, with his championship position being bumped down, crashing out of race one. He's way further down the grid, got a much taller order on, as we see riders already cutting over the curves on the warm-up lap. None of that in the actual race, please, young riders.
Yep, exactly. So nice to see as well, it looks like the whole of Team Suzuki X-Star are down there.
I know.
Bit of a party there. So yeah, it's going to be an interesting one, I think, this one. Like you said, with those slightly different grid positions as well, because we have seen it a little bit tougher to overtake at times, so it can be key. Not for Pedro Matos, of course. He's just done it every race so far and made it look effortless, but we're ready to go. And Tetsuta Nagashima as well down here.
Yeah, he's looking to start to play a key part in the Japanese Mini GP series next year.
Yeah, we're hoping that they will join the series. So far confirmed for next year, Qatar will start next year. Indonesia was supposed to start this year, then unfortunately due to the pandemic will start next year. And we're also welcoming Australia and Austria as already confirmed.
So wowee.
Hopefully we'll get a few
proper
more.
Proper international then, eh?
And, exactly.
I'm guessing we don't have the calendar for next year, but you'd love to have the world final on site again. What an experience this has been for all these young riders.
Yeah, for sure. I think that will be the plan. And Valencia is traditionally our season closer, so we may be welcoming them back.
Here we go then. So, revs up, nearly, lights on, and we go racing for the final time in the FIM Mini GP World Series final. Here we go, everybody clearly away, no front wheels in the air. Who's going to get the jump? It looks like it's Olivares, who has got the whole shot in towards turns one, two, and three. Sensational start, pushing. Who was that going up the inside there? Oh, that was the number 26 of Liguri trying to go up the outside of O'Brien. But Ethan Rodriguez is in second place now, the first time he's not led.
Yeah, interesting that for sure, because we saw Olivares really hustling to try and find a way through, especially in race two. But in this super final race, he's got the jump from second on the grid. So not quite as we've seen
Bit of a moment there.
Bit of a shuffle, yeah.
And he nearly shuffled back James O'Brien. He's managed to maintain that third place coming in towards turn 13. Great start from the Irishman, but look at the trio of Italians. Another move going in there in towards turn 14. Not sure if there was an overtake, but here we are, finishing the first flying lap.
We are indeed. So it's a Spain 1-2, but it's the opposite way around to we've seen so far today. So great stuff from them. We've still got Ireland in third, and then we've got the Italian trio once again hot on the heels of O'Brien. So that will be interesting. And not sure who's the next one behind that little trio of Italians that we've got coming up on the graphics. I think we've got, it's Portuguese rider, so that's probably Pedro Matos, if form is anything to go by so far. Yep. Just saw the flag more than the number that time. We had a change for the lead.
Yes, but I thought he was going to get him back. He didn't quite, though. That was superb from Ethan Rodriguez. You've got to hand it to him. And he's already got a bike length or two in through turn 13 and in towards turn 14.
Yep, exactly. So that's good. Some elbows out then from Rodriguez to get back into the race lead. So that man knows something about elbows out. He's lost another position now, Olivares.
What a move from O'Brien in towards second place.
Yeah, that was really nicely done from the Irishman then. He's obviously feeling ready to give this one a real go. Let's see if he's got anything for the number 44 just ahead of him.
I've not seen anybody overtaken towards turn one so far today. We might have missed some off camera, but that was sensational from the Irishman. But that second place is under threat once again. You got the 26 there of Liguri, looking very, very tempted by that third potential second spot. Ooh, got to not run it too wide there for O'Brien. Different line choices there. Now turn 13. But look at this. All the while, Ethan Rodriguez making his way out front.
Yeah, he very much is, isn't he? So that shuffling only helping our race leader to just pull away a little bit more. So at the moment then, he's got quite some breathing space behind him. But O'Brien looks like he's holding on to that second place for now at the moment, as Oliver Harris looks to make a move back through, but it's all pretty close still in these top few positions. That Dulford second, and then another group just behind.
Borelli, your third place rider from race two, has made his way up to fourth position there in the sort of melee, but I don't know how long it's lasted. Has it lasted? Yes, it has. The number 24 is there in fourth position, but O'Brien coming under fire once again from Olivares, but he still maintains the gap just at the moment, but he's swarming all over the back.
Yeah, very much so, but good stuff from the Irishman so far to just make sure he can defend that second place. It is even more important than it was earlier on because they are double points up for grabs, so it's an even bigger gap between those two positions than it would be in a normal points scoring system race.
Oh, we have got, oh no, oh, that's Enriquez who's gone down, and that is his championship aspirations over and done with. Fan, I just wanted to point out before we saw that, it looks like Olivares is really struggling through turns 1, 2, and 3. He loses a lot of ground to O'Brien at that point.
Yeah, it seems like the Irishman's really strong there as well. Like we said, we saw him make that move there into turn one. Is this a replay there? Ooh. Oh, bit of a... Oh, just couldn't keep it going then. Yep, so that's a sad... sad conclusion to his first mini GP world final, but still some really good pace shown by Enriquez, so he'll take a lot of heart from that.
Oh,
sure.
Is that Borelli up the inside? Ooh, what a move that was. That was sensational. God, I could say that was overtake of the day. That was brilliant.
That was really good stuff, wasn't it? And nice and clean.
Oh, and
well.
Another one going up the inside. Oh, straight line. Oh, and he's been pushed right back. This is it then. So that's him out the threat for the championship, surely. Oh, it is. Who's that? It's gone down.
We've got a crasher there. Not sure who that is from the colour scheme on the side. It looks like it's Vuono, Italian rider. Vuono then. So, sad times for the Italian then. He's down. Rider perfectly okay, as you can see. But, yeah, so that was a dramatic few seconds, wasn't it, there? Some great action. But let's see what's happening back at the front once again then. Oh, no, we're going to get a replay of I think we're going to see Olivares.
Vuono's crash.
Just that sliding out then.
What a shame for him.
For the Italian rider though, because he's doing pretty well there.
Back at the front though, it looks like, well, what's happened is O'Brien has been shuffled back. We've got an Italian just ahead of him, but he's so strong through turns 1, 2, and 3.
Through there.
Really good, isn't he? So it was Borelli who's up to second place. Sensational.
It really is. So there's a lot at stake here then, because these two at the moment have shared those podiums, although O'Brien is ahead on points because of a better finish in race two, I think. So yeah, great stuff then in this battle, but it looks like Rodriguez has got this one done. If he can keep it clean, bit of a moment there for the number 22, but he tidies it back up.
Yeah, but that's Liguri just behind him, trying to chase him and overtake him for that final podium position. They've lost a little bit of ground to you got Borelli just ahead, and that is the move for third position from Liguri there. That was really neatly done. Clearly took something from Borelli's move a few laps ago, but O'Brien so strong out of the straight and into turns 1, 2, and 3.
Really got that nailed down, hasn't he? Really, really good to watch through there. So it'd be interesting as well if he can make a bit of an aggressive move stick there later on, if needs be, towards the latter stages. But at the moment then, it's a bit of a cruise out front for Ethan Rodriguez, and some clear air as well for Borelli.
Matos looking very strong there, isn't he? The Portuguese rider really chasing for the Irishman. I think though, in the midst of this race, we can pass back down to pit lane with Matt Burt.
Yeah, just very, very quickly, I've got Suzuki factory rider Alex Rins here. Alex, looks like you're really enjoying this super final.
Yeah, for sure. I'm really enjoying how fast they are. They are super fast on this track. They are also quite close. I mean, a lot of riders in the same second. So yeah, wishing good luck to all these kids.
And it looks like Spain, Ethan Rodriguez, the race leader. He looks a bit special.
Yeah, he's from Spain. He's pushing hard now. So yeah, let's see if he can get it.
Enjoy the rest of the race, Alex.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Bertie. And Alex Rins there. We see then, it looks like Olivares has regrouped and he's back on in the fight for the final podium positions, you could say. You have got the number 26 of Liguri leading O'Brien now in that third position still. Matos looking very strong, as I mentioned before.
Yeah, definitely. The Portuguese rider really in the mix for some... really solid positions in this super final race, so great stuff from him, with of course Miguel Oliveira having given some tips, I'm sure. Wow, that's really smooth through there, wasn't it, from Borelli. So great race from him. He's really grown throughout the day, hasn't he, and made some good progress. But this group remains as tight as ever, and O'Brien may have lost out a little bit on that initial second place, but he still very much elbows out in there, the Irishman.
He does have a very neat riding style, does the Irishman.
I'm
really
a
sort
fan.
Of keeps it
I'm
planted. Yeah, you can see others like sort of muscle it round a little bit more, but he's seems very, very smooth, does the young Pocket Rocket. Good on him. Where are we looking at now? This is the number 24 of Borelli there, just still maintaining that second place. But he's one of the riders who looks rather squirrely in towards that final turn. Who's that? Is that Dennis Ondue? Good to see him back in action, of course, this weekend after serving his two race ban. We'll see him out on track tomorrow in FP1.
We will indeed. So I'm glad you recognised him very quickly. I was like, who is that in the sun? But so plenty of people, like we said, down here to watch this event, and they're getting quite a show in this battle.
They really are.
It really is tight out there, but Matos looking very aggressive, looking for a real way through now. Portuguese rider, impressive in this race. Another one who's made progress throughout the day, and the number 46 of Olivares has done well to regroup, but he's not made much more progress, has he, since he tagged back onto the back of this little shuffle.
What a mix of nationalities we've got in these sort of leading groups. I know there's a lot of Spanish and Italians in there, but mixed with the Irish and the Portuguese as well. Really, really impressive. And that is exactly what this World Series is all about.
It really is, yes. So great stuff. You can expect some speed from the Spanish and the Italians always. But it's great to see, the likes of Ireland and Portugal up there as well. So it looks like, I think we're getting more company in this battle, to be honest. It's now a five-rider fight almost, and there's still four laps to go.
All fighting for that third position then. So four and a bit laps to go, more like three and a half, you could say. Actually now, with Ethan Rodriguez looking super strong out front, but is he being chased down by Christian Borelli? It looks to be getting
a little bit
closer every single lap. But not if he's making mistakes like that. That was a huge front end twitch for the Italian, who got third place in the last race. That might be curtains on his race-winning aspirations.
Yeah, it may well be, because he did seem to really be making some progress there, didn't he? I think we'll get a replay of that one.
Wowee, how'd he save that? Goodness gracious.
Yeah, very much. We've seen a couple not able to do that and head off into that other... It's not really gravel, is it? But just into that runoff area. But yeah, good stuff then. The Italian retains second. But yeah, I think that'll put a stop to his charge for the win. But these three then seem to have a little bit of daylight behind them, though.
And kudos to Olivares, who has made his way through on Matos, the Portuguese rider, to be fighting right on the rear wheel of O'Brien. He's trying to make his way through, wants to take that fourth position off him, make his way towards third. This is the rider who has finished second twice today so far. But O'Brien cutting such a tight line through there. Really impressive, I've got to say, actually. The variety of different line choices they're all making. Watch him through here, turns one, two, and three. I mean, look at that! Oh my goodness, that was brilliant.
I hope he
stayed on the track, though, because it looked a little bit too fast.
It did, yeah. I'm not sure if he's thinking he can create an open door at the exit there by just keeping it fully pinned, but might get tasty the final time through there. We'll have to wait and see, but yeah, some really great bravery from the Irishman around there.
It's a shame we can't actually see what has actually happened to him, because I don't know where he is on track. He's gone. He's been pushed back, so he lost the position then. Okay.
He did indeed.
So what a shame.
In the clutches then.
So here's what happened.
Here we go then. Just probably a little bit wide around there. Only a little bit. Oh, and then it was there.
Too much. Oh, wow. And another great save. Oh, well, I mean, if he misses out on the podium at the end of this race, unfortunately, I think he can hold his head high, because he has been sensational through that little first sector.
Yeah, most definitely a real standout performer is the Irishman. So great stuff from him, and aggression from Olivares there. But he saw that open door, had to try and get through it after his earlier moment. But no such dramas for the race leader, though. Ethan Rodriguez, I think he's going to make it triple treat. Was that we had a few weeks ago in World Superbike? Incredible day of racing from him. And then, Borelli as well. Really grown throughout the day. Really impressive performances from these two guys.
Smoothly through turns 14, 15 and 16. Ethan Al Rodriguez comes across the line. 3 from 3. He will be your Mini GP World Series champion. But what about filling out the podium? Oh, it's neck and neck across the line. But I think it was, in fact, Liguri who got just ahead of Olivares there. But second place, Borelli. So two Italians in the top three.
Yeah, impressive stuff from them after it really seemed like the upper hand was for the Mini GP Spain series, certainly after qualifying with that front row lockout. And we do have a race winner from Spain, but the Italians making that progress throughout the day. Great stuff. Good race.
Well, as we see them celebrate, I think we'll probably hand down to Parc Fermi, well, near Parc Fermi in pit lane quickly. Matt Burt, who have you got for us?
No. don't think we can.
No, I think we've got a couple of tech issues. So well then, you'll be hearing more from Matt in the Tours Parc Fermé. But good to see all this sportsmanship between our young riders. There it is, a confirmation. Obviously, the 2021 FIM Mini GP World Series World Cup winner, champion.
It's a lot of different permutations.
He's won all four races. He deserves every single, all three races. He deserves it all, doesn't he? So great stuff from the young Spaniard. He'll be over the moon with that. And you've got to hand it to Liguori as well. A podium for him.
Yeah, really good stuff from Liguori, the Italian, to get on that podium. So yeah, we've had a few different riders on the podium today and some good progress, like we said, but we've only had one rider on the top step. Really impressive stuff from Ethan Rodriguez.
Yeah, sensational. Enrolls the number 26 of Liguori then. And a little bit of rail, I suppose it wasn't a burnout.
I was waiting for a burnout.
really, really good that. A handshake incoming, I think. Is that from Liguori as well? There you are. Oh, a little hug too. Well, you look at the start of this round. I'm glad it's all televised and recorded, because it's one of those where what will we be looking back at this thinking in about 10 years' time or
what
so?
If
will
we're these two... the first people to commentate on the international broadcast of a champion's beginnings?
Will people still be employing us to commentate by that time that they could be a MotoGP?
You know, I have my doubts.
There's more chance of them being a MotoGP than that. But there we go. brilliant stuff. So it is. Well, Spain has ruled them all here at the first World Series event.
Yep, and on home turf. So hopefully they can have some celebrations as well. The Spain series, some great pace. And Christian Borrelli then will be back on that podium. One better than last time as well. Really great progress from him. Glasses off, helmet off, glasses back on. Good system.
I know the pain, young man. I know the pain. But that was really good, because he came from off the first, in the first race. He's been sort of slowly building it up, hasn't he? Because he started the first race in eighth position on the grid. Then would have been a little bit higher up. Sensational stuff. But all these young lads will be very, very content with that, I should hope. Especially Liguori, first podium. Doesn't look too elated, though, does he?
I was going to say, he should be the one that's really, really pumped about getting on that podium. So, but it was a really good race. Like we said as well, really good progress from Liguori and from Borrelli as well throughout the day. So I think fair to say Ethan Rodriguez, from when he took pole by nearly 0.4, I think it was clear he was going to be tough to beat. But the other guys as well who've moved forward, that's good progress in itself.
Well then, Ethan Rodriguez Alvarez, I suppose, is the Mini GP series appropriate to say remember the name? Because sometimes we say that about like the Moto3, newly crowned Moto3 world champion Pedro Costa, and it's like, there's no need to remember that name. He's going to make you remember that next year in Moto2. but these young riders, the very first step of the road to MotoGP program, I think worth saying, remember the names that you see. And frankly, all 29 riders who have competed here in this two-day event, frankly, they are the best of the best worldwide at the moment.
They are indeed. And they'll have some more competition as well next year in the world final, like we said, with four more series already confirmed to be added. So the competition's only going to get closer and closer. And this is a fantastic starting point with some really impressive performances. And yeah, it was a bit of a domination derby at the front after the first few laps, but a lot of riders close together fighting it out, and great performances throughout the field.
This was the race winning overtake then, so that was a very, very well done by Ethan Rodriguez there, sort of on the inside, on the outside, maintaining that sort of speed. Brilliant stuff. And this was the moment that Olivares, in fact, lost that, well, any sort of command in the second place. I think these are just some replays rather than actual highlights. That was a great move into turn 14. Saw a few of them. This is Borrelli saving a huge front end moment. And here was, unfortunately, the end of the podium contention for O'Brien. He was brilliant through turns 1, 2, and 3.
He was. Oh, it got close there. It really did. But, this number 44 ruled the roost today. Ethan Rodriguez, he's also the champion with that as well. Pablo Olivares is second overall in the standings. So good day's work from him. Obviously, it was double points in the superfinal race, but he had those two second places earlier as well. And then I think it's Borrelli who's going to take third overall. And I think we're going to hear from man of the moment, Ethan Rodriguez, in just a couple of seconds with Matt Burt.
Ethan, congratulations. You're the first ever FIM Mini GP World Series champion. Tell us how that feels.
I'm feeling very happy because the final race is very, very difficult, and thanks for my team and my family.
Huge congratulations, Ethan, well done.
Absolutely sterling stuff. Already got his Parc Fermé interview style nailed as well.
Absolutely.
A star of the future for sure.
The other Ethan Guevara needs to buck up his English a little bit more.
Yeah, come on, yeah.
Some competition for the Moto3 guys there.
I'm sure his beloved press officer Vicente Villa will be watching this, listening in and taking note.
Yep, absolutely. No, this it is. I speak a couple of languages, you speak more as well. Confidence is difficult, and especially when you have a camera in your face. I am always impressed with those guys who have to communicate in their second language and from so early in their careers. And great to see a nice little Parc Fermé moment there from our new champion.
Yeah, first experience of that. Fermé now De Geer there as well, who's come along to watch. I mean, and also Lorenzo Filon, mind you, those two, well, especially Fermé being, 16 still? This could have been him, 2 years ago on these Ovales.
Yeah.
Some of them are 14.
I'm not sure about the whether his height would necessarily take to it so well.
Gosh.
But yeah, pretty crazy, isn't it? Already Moto2 European champion.
And World Championship Moto2 rider for next year as well. So, we said it time and time again, Fran, but how awesome is it to see so many riders from the World Championships here to support the potential stars of the future, their potential future rivals even, depending on career spans.
Yeah, absolutely. They really are, because obviously this weekend a big one with the farewell to Valentino Rossi, whose career has been unbelievable, 26 seasons. So, there is a very much chance that a few of these guys may be racing the guys giving them the trophies.
Very, very cool. And big smiles, them lot chatting together as well behind the podium, getting ready to come out. We all hear, of course, the Spanish national anthem for a third time here at the FIM Mini GP World Series finale in Valencia. But here we have then, you can probably hear Matt Burt announcing it. It will be your third place rider coming out onto the podium. It is Eduardo Liguori. Doing his leathers up, sponsor correct, of course.
Second place and congratulations goes to MiniGP Italy rider Christian Borelli.
Christian Borelli heads out onto the podium as Liguori finally gets his leathers done up.
But please give a huge reception to our triple race winner and our first ever FIM MiniGP World Series champion. Congratulations to Ethan Rodriguez.
And Ethan Rodriguez, three-timer winner in the races and at the overall champion for 2021. What a special title that is for him.
Presenting the third place award, please welcome onto the podium Team Suzuki X-Star MotoGP rider Alex Rins.
And how about that as well? Getting presented trophies by none other than a MotoGP rider themselves. Alex Rins coming out to present the second and third place trophies.
Some smooth fist bump in there.
Yeah.
And Alex also has the pleasure of handing over the runner-up trophy to Christian Borelli.
Second double duties for Alex Rins. So take a guess as to who might be presenting the winner's trophy.
The guy who's just and been stood too far in shot.
To our first FIM MiniGP Series champion, it's my pleasure to welcome 2017 Moto3 and 2020 MotoGP World Champion Juan Mir.
How about that then? A MotoGP World Champion presenting the trophy to these young riders. That must be an even more special moment.
Congratulations to all three riders on the podium. We will now hear the national anthem of Spain.
It would have been very special the first time, even more so the second, but that must have been the icing on the cake for Ethan Rodriguez. A Spanish national anthem for his race victories three times here today, and also the FIM MiniGP World Series Championship as well. We'll be getting a look very shortly at some highlights from the day. You can see down there also Lorenzo Fallon has joined the party as well. So just real smiles all round. Of course, the Valencia Grand Prix weekend gets underway tomorrow. You should know that already, I hope, but if you don't, there you have it. FP1 coming in the morning. So it's been racing, well, on all 4 days, basically, isn't it, of the Grand Prix?
So here we have the final results then. These are of the race. It was Ethan Rodriguez from Christian Borelli and Eduardo Liguori, with Pablo Oliveres, Josh O'Brien, Pedro Matos, Matteo Misili, Martin Reich and Tadej Benacek in the top nine. We'll see who completed the top 10 in a minute, I'm sure. I rushed through that rather quickly.
Yeah, please have patience with us. We don't have the results other than this.
And then we had Jesse James then completing the top 10 from the North America Series ahead of Samueli Ubaldi, Ruben Nyland after that crash earlier on, and Jaden Fernandez then rounding out the finishes in that super final race. And then the standings.
Yeah, what does that do to the standings then? Ethan Rodriguez takes 100 points away from the day. Pablo Olivares, second place with 66. Christian Borelli, third with 65. 1 point between it. Liguori finished up fourth from Rebrian, Matos, Masili, Banacek and Rice. Another Portuguese rider there in the top nine. Their future looking very, very bright indeed. With Buono in 10th, Baldi, Nyland and then Enriquez, Shedden and Fernandez bringing up the 15 riders who competed in that super final race. Well, I hope you enjoyed that and all of the coverage from today. It's been a sensational day's action. I think we will be getting a look at some final race highlights, I should think, even though we did see some of them a little bit earlier. But before that, we'll be getting going with the championship podium. So you did see it was Ethan Rodriguez and Pablo Olivares. And we'll have, of course, Christian Borelli, third position then, waiting around. Set out onto, yes, a world championship podium at a Grand Prix World Championship event, Fran.
Yeah, it's pretty special stuff, isn't it? And Ethan Rodriguez now making it feel like home after his incredible success today. But yeah, great stuff from those guys. And you can see everyone still very much there in the grandstand as well to watch the prize giving after this inaugural World Series World Final.
World Final
after the inaugural FIM Mini GP World Series. We could put it that way as well.
Yeah.
But yeah, great to see all of the sponsors who make it possible as well. They're waiting to see the prizes given. From Ovale Pirelli.
As well, Fran, this weekend, I mean, obviously this is going out on the FIM Mini GP social media channels. Obviously, plenty of people involved love watching the events all around MotoGP. You've also got the eSports World Series taking place, the final taking place this weekend as well.
Yeah, Global Series round four are we on now? I think we're on round four. Nice. They're very close in the standings in the eSport as well. Make sure you check that out on Friday.
And that is actually taking place right next to where the karting circuit is here, where the Mini GP is taking place.
Yeah, so. And if you're done with that, then you can also pay a visit to the MotoGP VIP Village, a good few metres further towards the paddock.
Yeah.
There's a lot of attractions around circuit, Ricardo Tormo circuit this weekend.
And still need to crown a Moto2 world champion as well in the three main Grand Prix classes. It's just all action in Valencia this time of year, isn't it?
It is. It's been a crazy but great week, I think, in the run-up to the event.
Yeah.
And great to have some racing on Thursday as well.
Yeah, really, really is. Start the weekend off with some excitement. We'll be exhausted before we even get to normal race day, to be honest, at this rate. And that's just
not
the
ready.
Commentators.
I'm not ready for the adrenaline. Not ready.
All day. I mean, it's...
This has helped me, though. I've not had my usual margin of coffee today.
No, yeah. I've only had two coffees, in fact, yeah. Yep. Didn't need it. The action's been too good. So, great to see also Peter Hickman still waiting around and watching all of the action going on. Really, really enjoyed it. You've seen just to the left of your screen there with one of the Moto hats on. Even he get to see someone who might brush shoulders with someday in the future. That must be very cool. I wonder what he'll do with that hat. If it was to lay up in his bedroom wall, it will be on the mantelpiece at home. Does Spain have mantelpieces? Is that a thing?
I mean,
carpet's not a cultural thing in Spanish homes.
It is not. So, you know, as we found out
for our dear colleague Greg Haynes.
But right, we're underway then. No more mantelpiece chat. We'll leave that for later.
Mini GP World Series.
So I think we're going to get the third, second, and first in the standings.
Luis Berengay from Team RFME, who are our first team champions.
We've got the team champions, of course, first.
Right, okay.
Which is home turf heroes, Spain.
Please welcome to the podium in third position overall from MiniGP Italy, Christian Morelli.
We do hope you, dear viewers, can hear Matthew Burt's podium announcing as loudly as we can.
Otherwise, it's going to be some very awkward silences, but we're just kind of leaving it to him.
To Pablo Olivares.
Big cheer for Pablo Olivares. Clearly got a few family members here this weekend.
And give a huge ovation and congratulations to 2021 FIM MiniGP World Series champion, Ethan Rodriguez.
And there we are. The champ comes back out once again with his helmet. Sponsor correct, of course. Another handshake to his comrades and rivals.
Of our late CEO, Mr. Valerio Dalio, to hand over the team trophy.
Team trophy goes to, of course, MiniGP Spain.
Does indeed. So they're now the benchmark, aren't they? I have to see how it shuffles next season.
What do you mean
to
now?
Our top three riders in the MiniGP World Series. Please welcome FIM President, Mr. George Villegas.
And then,
so you get a medal for
overall
you get a proper
FIM medal as well.
Of
goodness
course.
Me, that's awesome. Give it a bite.
This is proper stuff. Do the full Rafa Nadal.
Or any Olympic champion, yeah.
Well, I am obviously a bigger fan of tennis. So great stuff then for Pablo Olivares. Got his medal. And then Mr. Villegas presents the winner's medal. Oh, nice hug there. Congratulations to Ethan Rodriguez. Truly deserved.
Yeah, seems like an absolutely lovely kid as well. They all do mind. They're all the super, super friendly little kids. And then the in the up and down the paddock. Can't say they're about 10-year-olds, can't you really? But to us, when they're on the track, they are purely young riders, that's for sure. And then what are they getting here, Fran?
That was Nick Cotinelli from Thermal Tech handing over some prizes to our top three riders. I'm now delighted as well to welcome special champions helmet being presented KYT helmets to Ethan Rodriguez.
Well, goodness me. So you don't get it revealed on the cooldown lap and have to fish it out the ocean like Pedro Acosta did. You get your own one.
Yeah, and very, very cool prizes from some of our partners for this event.
Promotion director Anna Espoleta to hand over the trophy for the 2021 FIM MiniGP World Series champion, Ethan Rodriguez.
Anna Espoleta handing over the trophy then. That will go on the equivalent of a mantelpiece, that's for sure.
We wish you a safe and successful Valencian Grand Prix.
Well then, so that's it for the podium ceremonies then. I think we'll be posing for a photo and we'll be getting a look at some highlights and be rounding out the show. What a day, what an event it's been. I mean, yeah, it's something like this. It's one of those like, wow. God, if this, everyone's thinking, if only this was around years ago. You know, it's absolutely perfect start. Next step on these young riders' careers, of course. And now just the question remains whether we'll be seeing any of them, who we'll be seeing in the Grand Prix series in the future.
Yeah, definitely. Sure, these guys can take a lot of heart from that. And, Eduardo Liguori, great stuff from him. Josh O'Brien, really impressed today. So some really great rides throughout the day from some stars of the future.
Well, here we are
here
then.
We go.
Highlights from the day. This is it then. Well, from the super final race, Alex Rins on the grid. Save the best till last, fan, with the super final. It was absolutely sensational from the get-go. Plenty of changes of the lead, daring overtakes, a couple of crashes as well with some guys losing sort of the front end and things like that. But all okay at the end of the day, which is what matters. These were some of the battles for the front. Real chopping and changing all around. Just action-packed throughout the day.
It was, and it was a great final race, wasn't it? A few more moves than we've seen elsewhere, like that one from Josh O'Brien, absolutely nailed it through there. Absolutely spectacular. A couple of others just not quite as lucky and having a few moments. So but riders all okay, which as you said is the main thing, but plenty of action throughout this super final race.
Yeah, brilliant stuff it was. Commiserations to the riders who didn't get the results that they perhaps would have wanted here this weekend, but we'll see plenty more of them in the future. Ethan Rodriguez is your champion for 2021, and we'll see you in 2022.
We will. Thanks for watching and see you soon.